Plus 2 is proud to bring you the 2 Plus 2 Pokercast, presented by the Pokerstars VIP Club.
This week on the 2 Plus 2 Pokercast, Olivier Busquet and Ryan Spittles. Now, here they are, offering open challenges on Twitter for 100K hoverboard races. Adam and Terrence!
Welcome to the 2 Plus 2 Pokercast, presented by the Pokerstars VIP Club. I am your host, Dave Schwartz, alongside Rossco P. Coltrane on the controls. And Terrence Chen in Berlin, Germany. Last day in Berlin?
On your show.
That's good, yeah. Last day in Berlin, or what's the plan?
It is the last day in Berlin. I'm flying out tomorrow. I'm flying out to Toronto. It's been an awesome trip here. We just did a last little bike ride around the city. It's not too cold today. It's like 10 degrees Celsius and cloudy, but it's been an awesome time. I've managed to stuff myself full of kebabs and enjoy everything else that's been going on. So yeah, how's everything back home? Is Trudeau mania sweeping our home nation, or what's going on?
Trudeau mania is sweeping our home nation. The landslide victory, of course, for the Liberals here in Canada.
I mean, that's surprising, right? Like they not that they won, but they won by like a lot.
It was really sort of an anti-Harper backlash, it seemed like, but you know, politics in Canada probably bores everybody. But one thing I did want to mention from the election, and this tilted the shit out of me, and I would never have noticed it before I started playing poker. I've been playing poker for a while, but you know, when I was a kid,
you wouldn't have noticed this when you were 14.
When I was like 20, I would have never noticed. I'm watching the CBC coverage of the election, and you know, some of the results are sort of trickling in, and how it works is, you know, for those who, I'm sure people have watched election coverage, but there's a certain amount of precincts, and you know, they'll have like 40 of 62 precincts reporting,
and it'll go like east to west, because obviously, like, you know, Canada's a big country, so you know, this is the part that is maybe a little bit unique to Canada and some few other countries, is that like we have what, 5.5 time zones or something like that.
Yeah.
So you know, all the eastern ones, you know, go to the polls first, and then it goes all the way to the west coast, and our votes never matter because the election's already been decided.
Already done. Yeah.
So but you start getting all the Newfoundland and Nova Scotia votes early,
right gone. So the lady is talking, they're pundits, right? They're talking about results. There's an anchor, and pundits are sitting there talking about the results. And there's a riding they start talking about, and it's got 192 precincts, 192 areas for votes to come in from in this riding. It had one precinct's results in. The vote count, and I'm not shitting you, was literally 29-10-5 of the three candidates. The commentator looked at those numbers and said, "Those are shocking."
Yeah, I mean,
one of 192 precincts.
What is the standard deviation on 44 votes?
Like,
in a single precinct?
Me. Like, how do you? How are you?
That's
just not,
like, 5 whole families, Adam.
The producer should immediately walk on stage and say, "You get off. You're done." Like, it's just so bad.
It'd be great, like baseball. Like, the guy gives up a home run and he just
like,
his manager pulls.
Yeah, they got somebody standing there waiting with a suit on, jumping in. But it's you know, you're watching the, and then I can't watch the rest of this coverage because the people who are putting together these predictions and projections are the same people that hired this idiot that just said that, you know, the fact that the incumbent had 5 votes and was losing by 24 votes, it was shocking.
Well, in this day and age, what are you doing watching TV to follow the news anyway, right?
Like, I mean, yeah, I like watching some people talk about different, you know, ramifications of different numbers and stuff.
So you like some talking heads.
I like some intelligent talk. Somebody who knows what they're talking about, but clearly on Canada's national.
Most of those guys aren't on TV anymore, I feel like. Like, most of those guys are like,
Rex Murphy.
Journalists on like Twitter, and, you know, they work for like alt media on the internet and stuff. Some of this.
True,
it just seems
right?
Like, there's so few good, like, journalists that are just like on regular TV now.
Yeah, they've all been raided by the online sites. It is October 22nd, Pokercast 385, and why October 22nd is relevant is yesterday was Back to the Future Day, October 21st. I'm sure everybody out there has seen Back to the Future, right? Part 2, Back to the Future, the movie from 1989, Marty McFly travels to October 21st, 2015, to save his yet-to-be-born kids from certain disasters. So, that, I mean, I love those movies when I was growing up, T. I mean, I realize I'm older than most, but that are listening or here in this conversation. But Back to the Future was, you know, one of the seminal.
Yeah, it's part of the cultural. You know, I mean, I bet even Ross, who was not even born yet,
Ross, have you seen all three?
You've probably seen.
You have?
Yeah.
No, I wasn't going to say anything. I haven't seen any of them.
Oh.
Wow.
Yeah.
You've never seen Back to the Future.
I may, part of the culture. It may have been on TV and I've seen bits and pieces, but it's just one of those movies.
So not even the original, huh?
No.
Crazy.
Because, I mean, I'm going to be perfectly honest. I mean, Back to the Future, the original, it's a pretty classic movie, you know, did some clever things with stuff. The sequels were not that good. Like, let's really be honest about this. Like, the original, like, yeah, okay, the sort of, it was the first sort of movie that really brought traveling back in time and sort of parallel universes and the way that, you know, the sort of butterfly effects that can happen. You know, one of the first few mainstream movies that talked about that. But Back to the Future 2. I was surprised that it was like this much all over social media yesterday that everybody was like, oh my God, today's the day, because I just didn't think there were that many Back to the Future 2 fans.
Well, what's interesting about Back to the Future 2 is the predictions. Of course, they travel forward to October 21st, so there were some, you know, predictions, and they got a staggering amount of them very right. Now, how hard was it to get the ones that they did get right correct? Then that's a different question. So some of the things they did get right. They had something that's kind of resembled an Apple Watch, you know, that's sort of interesting. Flat screen TVs. How difficult was that? I mean, you got to think back to when in 1989, all these TVs.
It took up like a quarter of your living room if you had like a big nice TV.
And it was 400 pounds, right?
Yeah.
It was giant, these CRT screens. Video conferencing was something they had there. News drones, which I thought was really cool. Coming out of the courthouse, there's a drone that was flying above taking coverage. Hands-free video games. Again, probably not real difficult. Video glasses. So like Google Glass, which I don't think that's an easy one to call. I mean,
yeah, fair enough.
One of the other ones was, and they didn't get it right, but they almost got it right, was the Cubs in the World Series this year, which is not easy to get right because the Cubs have been terrible for so long. They almost made the World Series, but they got swept in the
NLCS. Well, maybe I should go back and watch it. You know, I've never really thought of Back to the Future 2 as like a much rewatch movie, but maybe on the anniversary I'll do it. But
And I think they're releasing remastered copies. Some things they got wrong, flying cars.
People don't give up money for free. Like, it's like if it's all over social media, you should probably find a way to monetize.
Oh, for sure. Hoverboards. Although
people have been complaining about that one for a while.
We're kind of close, right? I mean, there is some sort of things that resemble hoverboards. I think you have to be over sort of a certain fabric or something, whatever it is that they hover over.
Yeah, I mean, they've got wheels, right? Like,
true. Last night on Jimmy Kimmel, Christopher Lloyd and Michael J. Fox came in character, drove in the DeLorean, and in the middle of Jimmy's monologue, it was pretty funny. The other one they got wrong, Marty wears two ties. I don't know if you ever saw that, but he has two separate ties on.
That's like supposed to be the fashion in the 2015.
Yeah.
In the 2010s is the double tie.
Speaking of
movies, they didn't realize that the actual uniform of the 2010s would be like yoga pants for women and like hoodies for dudes.
Did you see the Star Wars trailer, T?
I didn't. I am one of the seven people who managed
You've never seen it?
I didn't either.
I probably will after. I haven't been specifically avoiding it. It's not like I'm anti-Star Wars or anything.
35 million views.
I just haven't gone out of my way to watch it.
Really?
Pardon?
35 million views in 3 days.
Yeah, so I guess
not one of mine or Terrence's, apparently.
Really? You haven't seen it either?
Apparently, I only watch documentaries now.
Me too. Ross and I just trade documentary tips and recommend them to each other. We call that segment Favorite Things. It's at the end of every show.
December 18th, Star Wars. Looking forward to that. The movie I really want to see, though, is Hateful Eight on Christmas Day. Looking forward to that. All right. Today we have Ryan Spittles. He's a professional poker player and commentator on Sky Poker in Britain. He's on a tour of the U.S. and the U.S. poker scene. We're going to get him on the show talking about that. And we have Olivier Busquet, who has agreed to fight JC Alvarado. Terrence, you're right in the middle of all this. We'll get Olivier's take on the bet, on the fight, and the reasons why he's doing it. Of course, Matthew Hilger from Pokerstars is going to join us later and talk about all things Pokerstars as well. Should we kick things off with the Internet Poker's Wall of Fame, T?
Absolutely, yeah. Do we play the drop first, or do I start?
No, I think we should play it after we induct.
Oh, okay.
That's fair enough. Okay.
So then there's going to be a big announcement. All right, Terrence, who are you announcing for the Internet Poker's Wall of Fame this week? Remember, we have two this week because we didn't do one last week.
Yes. Far be it for us to shirk in our responsibilities and fall behind. You know, you never want to get yourself in the debt because the interest payments on Internet Poker Wall of Fame inductions is brutal.
Yeah.
But let's talk about a topic that we've talked about on this show for as long as I've been a part
of
the show.
It's a hot button, yeah.
Certainly a lot of issue, and that's HUDs or tracking. How much time have we dedicated to this topic in the last year of the show, and how many vociferous arguments have been on across 2+2 launched across threads and threads? How many hours have been spent in the boardrooms of PokerStars, Party Poker, Full Tilt, and probably every other significant poker site discussing them, whether to embrace them, ban them,
countless,
or take another policy on them? Other than perhaps women in poker, there's not a single concept more associated with the phrase good of the game than the simple HUD. Whether you use one or not, the HUD is now ubiquitous in online poker. It's one of the first questions that gets asked in any interview with a successful online pro. Do you use a HUD? Should HUDs be banned? Should people be able to stream with HUDs?
What's on your HUD?
But where did the HUD begin? Simply, a poker HUD is useless, of course, without an underlying database. And the first commercially available database in online poker was called Poker Tracker. Poker Tracker was launched commercially on August 20, 2002, an eternity ago.
Wow.
While you never would have guessed it had the ability to completely change the landscape of online poker, it was even at that time a surprisingly powerful tool. Poker Tracker was originally just that, a tracker. It tracked ring game wins and losses and eventually included functionality for sit-and-goes and multi-table tournaments. At least originally, it wasn't a tool to exploit fish, although it quickly became obvious how to do so. But long before popularizing VPIP and fold to 3-bet into the vernacular, for the first time in poker history, poker players could actually see whether they were profitable from a given position or with a given hand. People who grumbled, "I always lose money with jacks and no limit," would in fact be able to see instantly what their overall profit and loss was with those two jacks. People began adjusting their button opening ranges and their big blind defenses. I was one of the first customers of Poker Tracker. At that time, I was an up-and-comer in the poker world, and I saw its value immediately. I spent most of my early years of my online poker career combing through my own results. Was I playing too many hands from early position? Was I bubbling too often in party sit-and-goes? Poker Tracker remains one of the biggest leaps towards online pokers attempting to identify a game theoretic equilibrium to Texas Hold'em. Poker Tracker would eventually start to see competition in the form of Hold'em Manager, and the two dominant tools in the online poker world would, as so happens in free market competition, drive one another towards more and more innovation and more functionality. In 2001, before the launch, there were really only two types of entrepreneurs in the online poker world, those creating poker sites and those who played for a living. But the rise of the databases set in motion another trend. Individual poker players started to create tools often overlaid on the APIs of these databases. People customized their own scripts. They started selling them. An entire cottage industry was created by other hobbyists and would-be entrepreneurs who wanted to provide more data, more automation. Today, 13 years after Poker Tracker's release, this is where we stand, with one of the most consistently debated topics in our world being to what extent computer assistance should be provided when we in fact play poker on the computer. So who is the man behind the software? Unfortunately, I don't have a very good answer to that. That remains one of the few mysteries in the online poker era.
Oh, I thought we were going to bring him in now. Here he is.
Yeah, exactly. We dug him out of a cave in Pakistan. What we know about the man is his name is Pat Isaac, and that's actually about all we know. He was called Poker Tracker Pat. He was better known as on the 2+2 and RGP forums and through email, and he's all but disappeared from the poker world. My attempts to find any kind of contact with him were met with dead ends. It seems that after the sale of Poker Tracker, he wanted nothing to do with the poker world. What I can tell you is that Pat offered tremendous customer service and he stood behind his product. Anytime I had some sort of database failure, hard drive crash, he was of assistance getting my database back online so I could continue putting my stats under the microscope. But I didn't even know his surname before going off on the search. Pat Isaac will almost certainly never listen to this show, but he set up the first in a row of dominoes which is still being knocked down across the online poker landscape. So wherever you are, poker tracker Pat Isaac, welcome to your spot in the Internet Poker's Wall of Fame.
Love it.
Internet Poker.
So if you're going to do voice, computerized voice, why didn't it say Internet Pokers?
Yeah, I could do that.
Can do that. Fantastic.
You're missing
choice.
The all-important S.
Right, because that's going to distinguish us from the actual Internet Poker Hall of Fame. Fantastic choice, T. Love it. I was also one of the first customers of Poker Tracker. However, I didn't use it at all in my entire online poker career as much as I should have. I didn't get near as much out of it as I should have. And I think...
Did you mostly use it as like a fish finder? I mean, eventually a lot of people use it. You just would use it as a fish finder.
Mostly. And then a little bit of, or a lot of it, the hand replayer they used to have playing back by hand.
Yeah, that was really cool. So, I mean, you know, obviously now we live in an era where automatic hand replays. But before, when you looked at a hand history, you actually had to put it through software if you wanted it to look like a poker hand.
Yeah, exactly.
Because you were just reading hand by hand of text of, you know, Adam folds, Ross raises to 250, Terrence calls 250. Like you just had to read the text, which everybody's familiar with. But, I mean, when you were able to visualize it, Poker Tracker was one of the first few tools that actually could visualize a hand history.
Yeah, those were great. And but back then, in the heyday of Internet Poker, you really didn't need – if you didn't use Poker Tracker and you were a good player, you were still going to win a lot. So it's not like today where if you're not using tools like this, you're in big trouble. If you're a full-time player, back then this was great and it would help you win, you know, 6 big blinds per 100 instead of 5, right?
Yeah.
Now it's the difference between winning and losing, but back then, a lot of people didn't use it near as much as they should have, like myself, because you were still making so much at the time that it was a sort of a small thing.
And in terms of HUDs, I mean, I think HUDs provide like this lot. Like, there wasn't a lot of really hardcore multi-tabling back then, right? Like,
right, you could play
like
four
tables. You
might
have people playing 2 or 3 tables, but very few people were even playing more than like 6. Like, if you played 6, like, you were considered like some sort of crazy, like, savant wizard, right? Like, so you didn't, you can actually pay attention to 2 or 3 tables. So it's not like you really needed to know, like, oh, this guy's playing every hand. You would just see that this guy's playing every hand. That'd be very apparent. But, you know, eventually, like, you know, that's why I say, like, it's a self-analysis tool back in its – that eventually turned into, like, a fish hunting pool tool, you know.
Yeah, and now we have a word of spot in online poker where people are saying maybe we shouldn't have these tools, right?
We have to protect the fish.
Yeah, right. We have to protect the fish from these tools. It's gotten to the point where they've advanced so far. Like, I would love to see an original version of Poker Tracker. Wouldn't that be fun?
I've got some screenshots. I'll see if I can find them and put them in thread. I did do a lot of searching for the original Poker Tracker screenshots.
Yeah.
It's really easy to find Poker Tracker 2 screenshots. It's fairly hard to find Poker Tracker 1 screenshot. I'll just Skype you one right now, just so you guys can see it ahead if you want. But yeah, I'll try to throw that one up in the forum. But yeah, how's that for a trip down memory lane?
Oh, that's I see it now. That's exactly how I remember it. And
it's just over like a Microsoft Access database too. There's nothing really fancy about it.
Right, right. All right. Well, I don't have a long introduction essay like yourself.
Well, I'm the long-winded one around here.
No, it was great. I loved it. I just didn't get the time to do a long one for mine, but I don't think mine really needs one. This is the largest winner in cash games in online poker history. This man is up $17 million online. $17 million in his lifetime. Excuse me.
You wouldn't know that if it wasn't for Poker Tracker, by the way.
That's right. Well, these are hands tracked by High Stakes Database on his accounts at Full Tilt Poker. He's got a $5 million lead on Phil Ivey, who's in second with $12 million lifetime. This is Patrick Antonius. He obviously was one of the biggest winners at Full Tilt for...
Very good, thank you.
Nice. And Fitagrind was another one. That's the other thing about Patrick, because he had so... Like, it was back in the day when... Multi-accounting was not frowned upon, let's say. Right.
Especially on Full Tilt. It was just a fact of life on Full Tilt.
People were just going to be playing different accounts. I remember the classic L.A. Lezra on Poker After Dark talking about Patrick Antonius and his 17 accounts to Howard Letter. I remember he called him out on High Stakes Poker. No, so it was Poker After Dark. But Patrick,
which was sponsored by Full Tilt for almost its entire lifespan, right?
And we actually had Patrick on the show, the original Rounders show. Well, he was, I want to say he was in our first year we got him in like 2004, 2005, and it was hilarious. I wish I had, and I think somebody did have, was it Glenn Weber, one of our listeners did have
the archives
I mean, of the Rounders show. But listening to that interview now would be fun because nobody knew who he was at the time. We didn't know who he was at the time. I'm pretty sure the interview was a train wreck, given that we were just starting and doing this thing, and we didn't really know.
He probably hadn't done very much media at that point.
Exactly.
Not being a huge
or spoken very much English.
Right. So anyway, all the women that are going to be walking through the Internet Poker's Wall of Fame are going to be happy that they have the beautiful Patrick Antonius on the wall. Oh, Norman Chad's going to love it too, of course.
The most you can bet or raise is a size of a pot.
Patrick Antonius. Nice.
It's hoping
double shots.
Internet Poker.
Welcome to the Internet Poker.
Double this week in Wall the Internet Poker's.
Yeah. Wall of Fame. All right, let's get to some in case you missed it.
How did he miss the open goal? 6-4, and he comes up 0.
He's missed it! How on earth did he miss that?
In case you missed it, the World Series of Poker Europe is down to the final strokes in event number 9, the main event, and also has event number 10, the 25K Euro High Roller, is also started and underway. But let's go back. Event 6 was the 3,250 Euro No Limit Hold'em event, 256 runners. Your winner, Pavios Xanthopoulos, from, you guessed it, Greece, takes home 182,000 euros for his win. He actually cashed in the first event, too, the Oktoberfest. This is his first bracelet. Deep runs for Alex Rocha and Fabrice Soulier. And a min cash for Chainsaw, so that's pretty standard.
Greece just crushed this World Series of Poker Europe.
Three bracelets.
It's funny, you think of all the economic stuff between Germany and Greece, you know, The Greeks came over to Germany and just took all the money.
Took it back to Greece. Yeah, and when they get it back to Greece, I don't know if that's, it's going to go a long way. Let's put it that way. Given Greece's
economy. Yeah, you like stash that under the mattress and you know, you turn it.
Yeah,
into
don't
like,
put it in the bank.
Yeah.
Event 7 was the $550 PLO event. This is the low buy in PLO. 503 entrants. I actually thought there'd be more than that for 550 PLO event, especially.
That's surprising. I mean, I think numbers all across the board are really surprising. I know you're going to get to the main shortly, but I feel like that's a way smaller field than than expected. Obviously Vegas and Berlin are not apples to apples, but yeah, like 500 events for people who are bracelet hunting or people playing their first World Series event. Yeah, that's surprising. Maybe PLO is not as big in Europe as we thought it was anymore. I mean, what was the, I can't remember, we did the show last week, the numbers for the 500 Oktoberfest, I think we had like 2,200 players.
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
Four starting flights, granted, but yeah.
4 days different. This is the one-day start. But I would, you know, when we talk about PLO in Europe, I think it might be specific to, and I could be wrong, maybe the listeners can help us out with this in the show thread this week. The PLO popularity might be specific to the UK.
For sure.
This is in Germany. People aren't going to travel for one sort of PLO event. Maybe they'll be there if they're playing other events. But maybe in Germany, PLO isn't as popular as it is in the UK. 503 entrants, first place prize, 55,000 euros. Lots of big names. You know, when you have a low buy-in event, you think, oh, it's going to be a lot of no names at the final table, or, you know, newer players because, you know, maybe some of the guys won't bother with a 550 event, and if they do, it's going to be hard to get through everybody. Lots of them went deep. John Gale, who I believe finished second in the earlier event, he again went deep, finished 12th. Doug Lee, the toolbox himself.
It's not my day.
In fifth
it was
place.
Not his day.
Imagine if Doug would have won a bracelet and had a bracelet.
He played like like 70% VPIP at the final table.
He was smashing for a while.
Yeah, he ran really hot.
Yeah.
And then it ended.
Like, he had like something like 110 big blinds five-handed and managed to finish in fifth. Like, he was like a runaway chip leader even five-handed, I think.
Taking marginal spots by Doug Lee. I love it.
Yeah.
I think it's the right strategy. I mean, it was a tough enough final table that it, like, increasing your variance is certainly not a bad strategy. You just kind of blew it.
Yeah, but I don't think Doug sits there and thinks, this is a tough final five. I might not be the best player here. I'm going to take a bunch of marginal spots. You know what I'm saying?
Like, you're saying Doug Lee.
I think he thinks he's very good
to assess that there's some tough players.
That's what I'm saying. Some of those tough players were Shannon Shore, who is, of course, going after his first bracelet, of course, maybe known as the best player now to not have a bracelet. So many deep runs, so many caches. Ends up in third. The winner was the very popular and beloved Englishman Barney Boatman, who takes down his second bracelet. I love his quote. He said, any mug can win one bracelet. And it turns out any mug can win two.
That's right.
Which is awesome.
He final tabled the 3,200 or whatever it was?
He came, did he finish 11th? Yeah, in the PLO event. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
He had a chip lead, too. In the earlier PLO event, he was down to, I think he had the chip lead at 13 players, and he ended up 11th. So he ran bad, much like Mr. Doug Lee. But great to see Barney take down his second bracelet. He can't imagine that there was a more popular win there this week.
Yeah, definitely. I was actually in the room for his bracelet ceremony. They did that during the main event. One day of the main event. Definitely very popular. A lot of people there showed up for it.
Event 8 was the 1100 Euro Turbo event. I think it was a 2-day one event.
Correct.
Terrence, you're going to play in that event. I think when we did the show last week, it was the night before. You're going to go get and play that one at noon. What happened?
Well, I did play the event. I played one flight of the event. I busted out on 1A, and I had every intent to enter 1B. People who listen to the show will be not shocked to know that I very much enjoy turbo tournaments. I like fast structures. I don't like dicking around, and I also like, I'm pretty good with the short stack stuff. So I enjoy playing in these and getting these. So I played the first one. I busted. I had every sort of intent to re-enter. So at, look at the schedule, the day 1A actually was it was a 4 p.m. start on the Friday, I believe. Could be wrong about that. And the 1B start was the next day at noon. Okay, so around 11:40, I get my stuff, go start to leave the house, grab my roommate, Jen Shahadi. We're literally jumping in the bag yet. I'm about to get in the cab. I'm standing on the curb. I'm actually waiting for Jen. And so I just like refresh my Twitter feed. I'm just goofing off on my phone, and I see a tweet from Jack Effel that says the tournament's been pushed back to 4 p.m. And I'm like, wait, that can't be right. They wouldn't just push
minutes?
A tournament back. Yeah, like it's like 11:45 or 11:50 right now, or no, it's like 5 minutes before the start time, and I'm still waiting for Jen. She's still inside the house, and I'm responding like, wait, when exactly did this happen? Are you talking about today's event? Like, are you sure?
Right.
And he responds like, yep. I'm in the cab right now. He's like, okay, go home. Sorry about the inconvenience, but it's starting at 4 now.
Wow.
And I'm like, we're like, what? Like, I'm talking to Jen. I'm like, does this make any sense at all? And she's like, no, this is terrible. This is a terrible decision. They must have done it because she had gone out before with a bunch the night before with a bunch of poker players, a lot of German players, a lot of foreign players, and basically, people were doing what they often do on the poker tournament. They're getting drunk, they're having a good time in a foreign city. They were out partying, and they planned to late reg the tournament. And she said that this was a pretty common sentiment. Like they all knew the tournament was starting at 12, but they were just going to show up late. And so
nobody was there at noon, and Jack's looking around, going, "What's going on?"
Exactly. Jack is looking around. He said there's about 40 people, which to me didn't seem like a small number. Yeah, it's a 1K, so I mean you expect more. But he's looking around, and keep in mind, like I'm a little bit late too, right? Like, so I'm jumping in the cab at 11:50. I won't be there until after 12 as well. I'm gonna register like 10 minutes late. But he's looking around, going, "Well, I've got to make a decision on this. the decision, and he suspects, oh, everybody must have thought it was four because yesterday's tournament was four, right? So, I mean, you know, granted, it's a little odd to have the one on the Friday and one on the Saturday. One on the Friday start at 4 and one on the Saturday
not
start at
really,
noon.
Though. Like, Friday's a work day, and you know, that starts at 4. Saturday's a weekend. It starts at – I mean, that doesn't seem too strange.
Yeah, I'm with you on that one. I'm surprised about it as well. But, you know, that – you know, and then sort of I get home, and this just keeps bothering me. It's just like – this is like a World Series of Poker event. This isn't like, you know, the – $25 buy-in at your local, you know, casino in New Mexico, right? Like this is supposed to be like a prestigious event, and you got people, you know, showing up late. So I you know, I'm like, well, I should probably get Jack's side on this. Like maybe there was like a logistical problem, because right. What happened, I don't have the original tweet right in front of me, that he said was, it was something like, it looks like everybody thought it was late. And I was thinking, maybe, you know, maybe the dealers thought it was four, like maybe they like don't have enough dealers. And I'm like, well, that would be logistically awful,
right?
And that would be a huge mistake. But nothing you can do a tournament without dealers. Exactly. Like I don't get it. Like what do you mean everyone was asleep? Like, you know. And so I wrote him and I said, I don't understand what your response is. Like, you know, it's listed as noon on WSOP.com, and it's listed on the Spielbank site, which is what the German people go to. And then so he made the assumption that all the players must think the start time is at 4. And he said he doesn't want to lose a couple hundred players who missed the start time.
A couple hundred people thought it was 4 o'clock instead of 12? I find
that
really hard to believe. Yeah.
I mean, I think he's wrong. I after I tweeted that, Brian Hastings was the one person who tweeted at me and said I was one of those people. I showed up at the casino at like 4:15 and I would have missed it if it was at noon. But literally out of like 30 responses, nobody else said that you know, there were a couple dozen who thought it was a 4 p.m. start.
I'd
but it doesn't matter. Like, it's published
under,
on the website. It's not that hard to go to WSOP.com and see that it starts at noon.
Right.
So I wrote him back. I said, like, listen, like I have respect for you, but I think this is a pretty bad decision. Like, you can't turn away just like 50 people. Like, I planned my whole day around this. You know, I wake up at this time, I go to the gym and I eat and whatever.
So this is you on Twitter. You're talking to him.
Yeah. This is, I mean, this is me DMing him. Cause I feel like I should always give somebody a chance to,
before you blast,
to explain privately before I kind of like put them on blast publicly. Right. I mean, I think that's fair. I mean, I'm just saying, like, I think this is a bad look for the WSOP. He says, well, you know, you're a tough critic, but I'm making this decision based on the entire field, you know, sorry kind of thing. And I wrote back and I was unhappy about it, but it started to kind of eat away at me. And I just thought, like, well, you know, I'm an upset customer. At this point, this is sort of my personal view on things, is that this is kind of how you shouldn't do things. It doesn't look good. It doesn't make your tournament look like it's in good light. And, you know, the more I start writing, and I get on these, you know, people listen to the show know I get very ranty. And as I'm typing this, I'm thinking, I shouldn't play in this event. Like, come on. Like, I know it's only 12 o'clock to 4 o'clock, but I feel like it's ridiculous for me to write all of this stuff, to say all of this stuff, and then show up for the tournament anyway.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like poker players do this all the time. Like, we bitch, and we show up anyway.
Yeah.
You know? And sometimes you just have to put a stop to that. So I decided, look, I'm, you know, I wanted to play this event, but there's other things I can do. It's my first time in Berlin. Like, I can go to a nice
Not
dinner.
Not the end
can,
of the world if you don't play this event.
Yeah, I can go get a workout in. Like, I'll feel better about myself if I just don't play it. So I wrote up the blog post and that's what I wrote, and I sent it, and that was that, or kind of so I thought it was the end. But of course,
by the way, for those that don't know, Terrence has his own blog. You put up a post saying that you didn't think this was a very good decision. So it's sort of a public statement.
Yeah, it's similar to what I've said. I mean, I've sort of it's at TerrenceChanPoker.com. You can sort of see Jack's original tweets and also my sort of response to those, kind of saying, you know, bullet points saying, like, this is why I think it's a bad idea to do this kind of stuff, and you know,
here's, before you go on with what happened, it's just, for me, I understand Jack's issue. He's got pressure about numbers, mm-hmm. getting as many people as he can into these events, because that's primarily how he's judged, how many people came out to this event. And he's under a lot of pressure because maybe results aren't as good as they'd hoped. But you have a responsibility to the people that, like you said, that if there's 30 or 40 or whatever amount of people there are there at 12 o'clock to play in the tournament, it's so disrespectful to them to go, you know what, I need more numbers. Your 4 hours and your whole day isn't as valuable as my need for more numbers. So I'm going to switch now the time to 4 o'clock. You're going to have to sit around here for 4 hours. It wasn't an hour-long switch. 4 hours is a significant amount of time to find something to do. Anyway.
Right. And these things go late, right? Like so the difference between noon and 4 is like the difference between finishing at 9 p.m. and the finishing at 1 a.m., right? Like that's – like those are hours where you're sort of like, you know, waning in the day. You know, I think it makes a big difference how you plan your day when you do that.
Yeah. Anyway, sorry. that was just –
No, that's fine. So the next day – I guess Saturday is the main event. Well, it's 1A of the main event, so you could choose to play Saturday or Sunday. I chose to play Sunday or Monday. I chose to play Sunday. I figured, that's an interesting decision we talk about too. I figured that a lot of the Sunday grinders will be grinding online, so I chose to play on Sunday.
I wonder if a lot of, just to get on that for a second, I wonder if a lot of the guys, those grinders you were talking about, might play Sunday because if they bust, they can get to Malta a day earlier. I mean, it's a tight window to go from Germany to Malta to the start of that event. So I'm wondering in this case.
No, actually almost everybody here is going to Malta.
Right. So I'm thinking maybe a lot of those guys who would go, oh, I'll play Monday. I'll grind stars on Sunday. But and then they'd say, well, because of that tight window, they say, no, I'm going to play Sunday. I don't know.
That's interesting. That's a decent counter argument. I still feel like a lot of them will play online. And I will say that, you know, in my I didn't last. Spoiler alert! I didn't last very long in the tournament. There were not a lot of online pros at my table. There was a lot of sort of cash game pros.
Okay.
And there's a lot of live circuit pros, but I would not say there's not a lot of online pros. So I feel like I do.
You got the right. You got it right. Little. Yeah.
I come in and it's. It's actually like a really small turnout for 1A, at least on time. So I show up on time because I think, you know, it's a deep structure. You know, I think, you know, if there's some dead money, if somebody's going to just punt off his stack with aces in the first level, I want to be there for that. So I get there and, you know, obviously I don't know this, but I've got my seat card, you know, it says whatever 305 seat 4 or whatever. And I go over and table 305 is completely empty. So I have to go over to the tournament director there and get a new seat card, because I guess they, funny enough, didn't have enough tables. Because I guess what happens is if everybody shows up late, there might only be two or three players at each table, right? And then they don't want a bunch of like three-handed tables in what's supposed to be a nine-handed tournament. So they reshuffled the table. So I got a new seat card, ended up getting seated at the table right next to Jack and the other tournament directors. And I feel like Jack's a little bit frosty at me, but I'm like, okay, I can sort of understand that. I took our thing public, you know, but, you know, maybe he'll get over it or whatever. So I'm playing at this table, you know, just playing hands, but I can still hear them talking because they're literally at the next table. And I can tell that they're frustrated because there aren't nearly as many players as they're expecting right now. I think there's really only about 50-ish people actually in the room.
Okay.
Most of the tables are seven-handed, so it's looking like a pretty empty room. And, you know, Jack says something, I can't remember exactly what he said, but I sort of make a mistake. I give him a needle and said, well, maybe everybody thought it was 4.
And he blows
his top on that one.
What did he say?
Well, actually, I said maybe you should have started at, and he's like, did you know I had to fucking, you know, redraw the whole tournament? Maybe I should have started at 4. Did you know I had to redraw the whole fucking tournament? Did you know that, buddy? And I'm like, whoa, I was just making a joke. Maybe the joke was in bad taste, but I thought I'm a dumbass. I just thought I was trying to break the ice a little bit.
Well, I think people that don't know you, T, would take that, not so that Jack doesn't know you, but maybe doesn't have a lot of interaction with you. Like your dry sort of way you say things might be taken the wrong way. I know that you're joking.
Certainly.
Because we know each other, but maybe somebody doesn't.
Yeah, I mean, and that's totally fair. But he blew up. He lost the – he was
– Did he get in your face?
He was not happy.
Did he?
But I was like – I can't. Did you just say that? Like, are you saying I'm responsible for this? Like, this is my fault?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, dude. Like, the tournament starts at noon. It's been printed at noon on the website for a while. Anyway, he was not. I mean, I said like, listen, it's not personal, but and then we got into it quite a bit. And
oh, really?
Pardon me.
You got into it like yelling at each other?
Yeah, we were. I'll put it to you this way. I mean, I'm sitting in the three seat, and so he's also sitting in what would be like the three seat at like the next table over, right? So
yeah.
we're pretty physically close to each other. So we're not there's no real need to yell.
Yeah.
But on my table, I'm not watching the hand, obviously, at this point. But there's two guys that are involved in a big pot. Three guys from our table have to like chastise me and Jack because like, hey guys, there's a big pot going on here. Could you be quiet for a sec?
Oh wow.
So people like, and I'm generally like pretty
quiet,
respectful.
Yeah.
when a guy next to me is like playing a big pot, not to be a Jack, but he's the tournament director, and so we're both sniping at each other while these two other guys are trying to play a huge pot in the first level. So we were probably both a little out of line. I think we both recognized it later. Like, so I mean, I busted the tournament just before dinner. So I came up to him and said, like, listen, it's not personal. He was upset at you know, a bunch of stuff. Like, you know, he was okay, you know, with me expressing this in public or whatever. You know, he was okay with the direct messages, the needle. He said just kind of set him off. It's exactly like you said. It was just sort of like a misunderstanding about my my awkward sense of humor.
Yeah.
I guess. So oh, well. Yeah, that's the event. So I did not win.
That would have been awkward if you would have won.
Well, so I'm thinking the whole time the whole time between. You know, him yelling at me, and I ended up getting redrawn to a different table. I sort of made a joke like, you know, I wonder if I was redrawn like randomly, quote unquote. Because I got moved to like the complete other end of the room, like shortly after, like one of the other, like the assistant tournament directors was like, Terrence, and I'm like, yeah, it's like, he's like, are you the big blind? I'm like, yep, okay, you're going over with me. I'm like, did you just wait until I would be in the big blind? But anyway, I would assume it was random, and
of course,
but it was
yeah.
Funny. But this whole time I'm thinking, man, this is going to be so good when I win this event. And he has to put the bracelet on me. Like, just, oh, please, one! I'm going to use my one time for this one right now.
So what happened? You guys made up? What happened?
I mean, we talked about it. We put this through. It's sort of like I said. You know, I was surprised it got so personal. You know, he admitted fault for taking it so personal, but he also thought I was bullying him basically by kind of sending him direct messages on Twitter and going after it on the blog and needling in person. He thought that I was being a bully, and he was also offended because of what he'd said because of, you know, he's been helpful to me in the past. You know, he says like, you know, you've been playing the World Series for a long time as I've been charged. I've always tried to be very helpful to you and answer all your questions. And, you know, I went to the World Series in Cannes back, you know, whatever, 5 years ago. He's like, I was helpful, you know, help get you a ride from the airport
but
and all this stuff.
Hang
and
on
all
a second. Hang on a second. Hang on. He's the tournament director of the World Series. He owes it to everybody to be helpful and answer their questions. Like, how is that doing you a favor? That's what he's supposed to do. It's his job. Anyways,
yeah.
That tilts me all to hell. Because
I mean,
level.
I mean, I agree. Like, I think that's why I still feel like he has a greater sense of responsibility as wearing the suit. Like, yeah, like I lost, like I was out of line and he was out of line. But I think it's different when I'm out of line. Like, I don't want to be that jerk that says, "Well, I'm the customer, and therefore." You know, these people who walk into a restaurant and they think that they can abuse the waiter because you know they're paying customers. Like, I don't want to be that guy, but I also feel like I wasn't. I was just airing my expression of being unhappy with this. But I mean, he took it personally. He does take stuff personally. And
in fairness to him, I honestly think I understand how he took it personally when you did give him the needle like right there in front of people. And I get that you're joking, but I don't think it probably came off as a joke and he didn't see it that way. I get that. But...
Right. And I think further to that, I think he is passionate about his job. Like he's very fiery about his job. He likes being the tournament director of the World Series of Poker. He doesn't just think of it as a job.
Oh, sure.
And he takes a lot of personal pride in that. And I think almost more than he should, he doesn't have like professional distance, I guess is what it is.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I mean, that's fair, but, yeah, I mean, it'll be okay. I mean, I'm sure it'll still, you know, relationship, whatever. But yeah, I had a lot of tweets at me going, or a lot of people saying in person, like, geez, I hope you don't need a ruling today.
It sounds like he treats tournament directing like parenting.
A little bit. I think that's probably true. One of my favorite tweets was Lance Bradley, who said, hey, guys, I'm having a barbecue at 4. Unless nobody shows up, then it's at 8.
Just said nothing, like didn't reference anything.
Yeah.
Like that's like he just woke up in the morning and that's what he tweeted.
It was great. The winner of said turbo event was not Terrence Chan, it was Georgios Sotiriopoulos, who wins.
So I didn't win, not because I didn't play, but because I'm not Greek.
You're not Greek enough. Terrence Chanopoulos did not take it down. he wins the bracelet, 112,000 euros. Brian Hastings goes deep, finishing 7th in his quest to win the World Series of Poker Player of the Year.
Interestingly, had he won the event, he still would not be first. That would not have been taken
right.
Enough for him to be in first place because the buy-in was so small. But
we've talked about the formula is a joke. Yeah, it's terrible.
Yeah. well, but that's the thing, is because the formula is a joke because it's only quote unquote a 1K.
Right.
It doesn't matter in the grand scheme of the Player of the Year.
Hopefully the GPI and the World Series of Poker have a look at the Player of the Year race. The Player of the Year formula next year and do something about that because it's pretty clear that it's not good.
They have to, right?
You would think, but that doesn't make me 100% confident that it's going to happen. Anyway, Event 9 is the main event, of course, the 10,000 euro main event. We have talked a little bit about Terrence. 313 players entered. 883,000 euros for first place. 313, it's, I don't know.
For the World Series, for a very prestigious event, right? I mean,
yeah.
You know, you still remember the Annette Oberstad win and what a big deal that was. I mean, partly because it was Annette. But I mean, the World Series Europe's definitely lost some luster or whatever reason. I don't know necessarily why, whether it's in Berlin, whether it's the time of year, whether the EPT is just crushing too hard in terms of competition, whether it's the value of the bracelet. But yeah, very surprising.
I think, this is my personal opinion, I think the World Series of Poker Europe needs to stop moving around. I think it needs to be in London every year. And you know what I mean? Like, you just don't have the consistency to move it all over the place and have, you know, the crowd come back.
Know why they moved to Berlin? I mean, not that I'm complaining. I'm loving it here.
Yeah, I mean,
and I probably wouldn't have come.
And that's probably one of the reasons, because it's such a great city and people are going to want to travel to, you know, there's a segment of poker players that enjoy that, like yourself now, who want to go places for the place rather than the poker tournament.
That's sort of what the EPT is for, right? Like, if you look at the EPT's website, they've got like what, you know, some, all these poker tournaments, you can go pretty much anywhere in the continent and the Bahamas. You know, so it's sort of, I mean, I understand there's no EPT Berlin anymore, obviously, and maybe that itself is the reason why.
Yeah, maybe.
But yeah, I mean, certainly having it in London will, I mean, the UK is probably still, at least per capita, the greatest. There's still more poker players there than probably any other city in Europe. Is that a fair thing to say?
In Berlin?
No, in London.
London
yeah,
has more I really
than
feel
any, than any other European city, right?
I really think so. I think that's where the heart of European poker is right now. Yes, Germany is booming in poker and has boomed for, you know, the last certain number of years. But I think the heart of poker, you know, the World Series of Poker is in Vegas every year because Las Vegas is the place people go to play tournament poker. They're conditioned to go there during the summer to the World Series of Poker. That's what they do. could they have it in L.A.? Yeah, of course they could. But it wouldn't be the same. I think they just have
to. But having it in Berlin isn't even as much having it in L.A. as it is sort of having it in, like, Houston or something like that.
Right, exactly.
Like, because L.A. has a long, long storied history of poker. I mean, L.A.'s had you know, L.A. had Hold'em before Vegas did.
Right.
But, you know, so when you talk about Berlin, like, there is not a great history of poker here. I mean, you talk to most of the dealers who deal here, like they get like one table year round. They don't have it. Most of the dealers here are traveling dealers. Most of them aren't German. So yeah, they just don't have. I mean, yeah, Germany's been booming, but I mean, I think a lot of that, especially, has been online
and
maybe the live poker boom has kind of missed it.
And those are two different things. Yeah, online is booming, but that doesn't necessarily translate into entries as we've seen.
Yeah, it helps, but yeah.
313 entrants. They're down to eight-handed. Kevin McPhee is from the U.S. is your chip leader. 3 million and Chips.
A lot of big names at that final table right now. I know half of them. That Kramer guy was one of my picks for he went really deep in the main event.
Killian Kramer. He is in seventh, the German. Eric Seidel, Cyborg, is in second with 1.9 million. Lucky Chewy in third, 1.8. And JC Alvarado, Terrence's friend, who we were hoping to talk to in the show today about his fight.
Probably won't happen now.
With Olivier is sitting in sixth.
He's got things to do.
With 400,000. I think he's got, what, 20 big blinds or something like that? So,
yeah.
Good luck to JC. And, so the I mentioned the 25K high roller event number 10 is underway. 62 entrants, I believe, they got.
Wow.
And we will...
That seems high on the heels of the 10K only getting 300, right?
Yeah, strange, right? I think people travel for that one specifically, right? And, fly in just for the main.
Well, basically everybody who played the 25K... is playing the 10K, and then so I guess maybe going back a little, taking a step back again for the 10K, maybe it's just a sort of failure to run enough satellites, right? Because I mean, usually when you have these big high roller tournaments, it's like, you know, when you look at like the EPT high roller tournaments, it's often like less than 10% of the field of the main, right? Like the like you get these main event fields that are like 700, 800, 900 players, 1,000 players, and then you get these high rollers that are still like 100. You know, it's often just these really wealthy guys and these high stakes pros. But the main events are typically very well fed by satellites, and maybe that's what was missing from the main.
Not a ton going on this week in the poker world, guys. But let's get to some of the things that are. In case you missed it, Phil Hellmuth has been hired to coach a World Series of Poker November Niner. Federico Buttarone was hired by Phil to manage his 16 big blind stack. According to Phil, Buttarone will travel to Manhattan a week before the World Series of Poker final table and spend 5 days drinking from Phil's fountain of knowledge. What's that? He lives in New York?
Lives
I guess.
In Manhattan,
no, I think they'll probably meet there. I think Phil lives in California. He lives near Stanford Stadium there, Palo Alto. But, I mean, it's strange because Federico has 16 big blinds. He's not deep. He's on the short stack. Phil Hellmuth, is very good at multi-table tournaments. But I don't know that his method is teachable, especially, you know, he's got a lot of criticism for playing short stacks and doing weird things that aren't mathematically correct.
He makes insane laydowns.
Yeah.
That's basically what you're trying to say.
What I'm trying to say. But what I'm trying to say is I don't think his style is easily teachable, and I wanted to get your opinion on that.
Yeah, I mean, I would say that, you know, we've seen him do things like fold sixes, you know, like raise fold sixes with 12 big blinds or whatever.
He's raised folded hands with 4 big blinds, like done the weirdest
things. Yeah, it's just things that are very shocking, and I think if Buttarone goes down that path, it's not going to work out very well for him. But I think the thing is that Phil thinks that he's excellent in these short stack situations, right? And
right.
I think he's he's charismatic enough to a lot of poker fans and a lot of poker players that people would think that he's very good, because a lot of times, like, you know, let's say that you're in a short stack situation and you've got 8 big blinds and you raise fold sixes and the other guy turned out to have ace queen. Like, there's mathematically that's terrible, but there's a way that Phil has of justifying this, going like, oh, you know, I'll be in a better situation. I didn't have to race here, even though you're getting like mega odds to call with a 53% hand, right? I mean, I think he's got that ability, that sort of cachet to convince people that the way he plays short stack no limit hold'em is a good one, and I personally don't think it is, but I'm in agreement with you that I do not think that this is necessarily the best coaching decision. But maybe we don't know what's going to happen behind closed doors. I guess
that's called chewing your leg off to get out of the trap, kid.
He's going to teach him how to chew his leg off to get out of the trap. I remember Jeff Shulman when he made the final table in the year Jokata won. Hired Phil Hellmuth, and there were some rumors that maybe it wasn't Jeff, but another one of the people that hired Phil paid him 15% of his final win to be coached by Phil, and I'm just like, what? That makes no sense to me.
Oh, God.
And so it just kind of shows me that in this spot with Federico with 16 big blinds is not, I don't think, is making a very good decision hiring Phil for whatever he's paying him, because there's guys out there. Like, Phil's pretty low on the list of guys I would go out and hire to teach me how to work a small stack.
And, and the list of people that you would hire for a percentage is certainly even lower. Like, you'd, I would suspect most would want to hire people by the hour. I mean, I guess if you, there's the only reason you would ever hire somebody for a percentage is if you didn't think that they were going to give you like the best advice and you wanted to incent them. But why would you ever hire somebody who, whose integrity you, you doubted in that kind of a way, I guess.
Yeah. Interesting. We'll see what happens with that. Speaking of coaching, World Series of Poker World Series of Poker main event chip leader Joe McKeon has also hired a coach. He won't say who he's hired. It's keeping it a secret. His plan is to live for a couple weeks just before the final table with his coach. Now this is a guy with an overwhelming chip lead who seems like he's going to get a lot more value from a coach than maybe somebody with 16 big blinds.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's so many interesting spots that he'll be able to put people in. You know, he needs somebody who really understands ICM dynamics, how other people are going to be laddering up. That stuff directly affects him. I think most people would agree he did quite a masterful job.
Oh, he just ran
with two tables left. What he did. So he's only going to get better, I'm sure. Being the kind of guy he is, he's probably hired a real stud. Living for a couple of weeks with the guy is pretty hardcore. I mean, I sort of understand that for like, you know, MMA fighters and stuff like that. But he's not just going to go. He's not just, you know, doing some online Skype coaching sessions. He's going to go live with the guy. I mean, I kind of wonder what the relationship is in that way. That's really interesting.
Yeah, and, you know, we saw last year Martin Jakobsen spent a lot of time preparing, right? Both his health, his game. He spent, you know, most of the summer getting ready for the final table. But results oriented, he ended up winning. But I'm surprised, given that this is the biggest moment in everybody's life that's at this final table, that they don't do the same thing. We just talked about, you know, the fact that, you know, there's a couple weeks before the final table that these guys are going to start training. I'd be doing it already. I'd have been doing it since the moment I could.
Yeah, there's probably some ego aspect to it. Like a lot of these, like, oh, I play my style. I was the one who got myself here. If somebody else were to teach me, then you know, it might affect my game. I think there's these sort of like thoughts that sort of creep up that are based a little bit in ego. I mean, they have some truth in reality, too. I mean, you know, you have to hire the right coach, the coach that kind of jives with your style and, you know, jives with your mental, you know, the way that you approach the game. But, yeah, I mean, I think everybody should probably, anybody who's in this position should definitely have at least a small handful of people that they trust and that are going to work on their game with them. I mean, you mentioned Martin. I mean, I don't know if Martin specifically hired somebody that you would call his quote-unquote coach, but you definitely saw in the 10 for 10 documentary a bunch of people, you know, a lot of his close friends who are also high-stakes pros kind of training with him, taking different roles and, you know, discussing it. And yeah, you've got to do that stuff, I think.
All right, let's move on. In case you missed it, there was an article written this week about Borgata Poker Room, and it was on a blog site. The research, so to speak, in quotes, was done into a bunch of the statistics from a bunch of hands.
Offshore gambling websites.
The author came to some conclusions, and I started reading it, I was like, oh, this is going to be interesting. I don't know if you saw this, T, but we got through some of the methodology, and you just kind of went, what, this makes no sense. Wait a second, there's something completely wrong here. And then at the end of it, there was sort of this backhanded plug for America's Card Room, and you just kind of went, oh. And it's not attributed to anybody. That, you know, all the research is unattributed, and it just there. But a lot of people were talking about it, so I just wanted to quickly mention it. I don't think it's worthwhile spending any time on because of the fact there's so many flaws in the discussion. Just wanted to quickly mention that. T, did you read that article at all?
I did not. I mean, I saw the thread at NVG, and I quickly saw that the link itself was actually taken down by the NVG mods.
Yeah.
So they seem to feel the same way as you do about it, other than
it's not worth
you brought it up
into.
On the show.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I guess you could Google it if you wanted to find it. But, yeah, it seems like a waste of time.
All right, let's end the first segment there. We're going to come back. We've got Olivier Busquet, who's going to talk about his fight with JC Alvarado coming up next spring. And we've also got poker pro Ryan Spittles, who is the Sky Poker analyst from the UK. He's traveling around. We're going to get him on as well. A couple interviews coming up in segment two. Segment three, we've got some mailbag and some more in case you missed it to get to as well. And we're going to head out to the Isle of Man, talk to Matthew Hilger about what's going on over at the world's largest poker room. We are sponsored by CrushLivePoker.com. They are our strategy sponsor each week. Bart Hansen, our old friend, teaches you how to crush the live pokers. Each week he sends us a strategy minute, and this week the strategy minute is...
This week the strategy minute is about recognizing your stat to pot ratio in bloated pots.
You're stacked to pot ratio.
Yeah, so you can...
The most you can bet or raise is a size of a pot.
Yes, indeed. All right. Stacked pot ratios in bloated pots. Here is Bart Hansen from CrushLivePoker.com. You're listening to the 2 Plus 2 PokerCast presented by the Pokerstars VIP Club. More right after this.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to another 2 Plus 2 Strategy Minute brought to you by CrushLivePoker.com. I'm Bart Hansen, and today I want to talk about recognizing stack-to-pot ratios in bloated pots. Now, if you're familiar with a lot of my content over on CrushLivePoker.com, you know that in general, I'm not really a big fan of slow playing. But one of the situations that I think that you commonly can correctly slow play is when the pot is really bloated. And that usually happens in 3 or 4-bet pots, sometimes in 3-bet pots if the stacks are short, but most of the time in 4 or 5-bet pots, you know, your stack is only going to be maybe 1 or 1 to 2 pot size bets left. And you can oftentimes play those situations a little bit backwards. You know, you can make a 4-bet out of the blinds with aces, have a guy call you, and then check a ragged board. And the reason why you can do that is because you just don't need to build the pot up that much, and you play it a little bit deceptively. So the next time you have one of those big hands and the pot gets really big, remember this lesson. Now let's get back to the poker cast.
6 max zoom 500, 230 big blinds deep. MP opens to 10 and I 3 bet 36 on the button with kings. He 4 bets small to 63 and I 5 bet 143 and flat his $222 6 bet. Pot is 450 with 1000 behind. He bets 555 on the 10-7-3 rainbow flop. And I think, too bad I'm not capable of folding in this spot as I shove, only to see him turn over ace-10 after calling. I hold for 500 big blind pot.
Team Pro Online's Mikhail Inasai Shalimov is a Supernova Elite VIP. This is the 2 Plus 2 PokerCast presented by the PokerStars VIP Club.
Hey, poker fans, don't forget about the 2plus2.com digital magazine. Each month, a wide array of poker professionals and media write fascinating articles about the game you love. Want to learn about big blind versus small blind hand ranges? How about optimal Jeopardy daily double strategy? Topics like those and many others are covered every month. Head on over to 2plus2.com to see what the magazine has to offer this month.
Hey, it's Mike from the 2plus2 store and ProfessionalPoker.com. 2plus2 is pleased to announce the release of their most anticipated book in ages, Applications of No Limit Hold'em, A Guide to Understanding Theoretical Sound Poker by Matthew Janda. This book will give you the ability to create the bet sizings and ranges which will beat the better players. The theory in this book is not designed to be complex or abstract, but rather it's intended to be applied immediately, producing better overall results. Many confusing concepts, such as overbetting, balancing multiple bet sizing ranges, donk betting, and check raising as a preflop raiser, are crucial to a player strategy, despite few players implementing them or talking about them. And after reading this book, you should be able to not only conceptually understand these ideas, but also know how to begin incorporating them into your game, and thereby successfully compete against tough opponents. And at the 2plus2 store, we accept all credit cards, plus PayPal and NetTeller.
Attention everyone not named Alan Kessler. Have someone you would love to appear on the PokerCast? Have someone you don't want to hear again on the PokerCast? Head on over to the Suggest a Guest thread in the PokerCast forum at 2plus2.com, and Adam will do his best to make you happy. P.S. Chainsaw, you can post too.
Hey guys, this is Bart Hansen for CrushLivePoker.com. Whether you're a recreational player who wants to compete at the tables, or you're a professional and you want to increase your win rate, the material that I've produced at CrushLivePoker.com will make you a better poker player. Act now and you can subscribe for free by using the coupon code TPC11. That's TPC for the Pokercast 11 and get your first month free.
Brought to you by the Pokerstars VIP Club. Adam, why don't you just sit down and have a seat for a bit?
You're going to take over. This is your area.
Yeah, we're in my wheelhouse here. There was a little news item that probably came across your Twitter feed this week. Olivier Busquet, of course, one of the best high stakes no limit players in the world, is going to be fighting another high stakes no limit player, JC Alvarado. They are going to fight five MMA rounds, or it looks like four MMA rounds with an overtime round if necessary. This is going to happen sometime in the next 6 months, by the looks of it. They're both new to MMA. They've never fought before. Let's set the stage now. JC's busy actually still playing in the main event, so we were hoping to have them on for a little bit of trash talk, but we've got one half of the fight. Olivier Busquet, welcome to the PokerCast.
Yeah, hey guys, thanks for having me.
So this is obviously really interesting to set the stage for those who haven't heard of it. He's given you some odds. If you take down this fight, you will be 150K wealthier. And meanwhile, if he manages to beat you, he's going to have 120,000 of your money. It's a big money fight, actually, is in terms of MMA goes. Talk about how this started, because you're not known as an MMA guy. It just kind of seemed to come out of the blue. You posted on Twitter, "I'm looking for a fight for six figures or more." What gives?
Yeah, so it's funny because a lot of the people who have, I guess, either been in a conversation like this about doing a fight or whatever are like serious MMA enthusiasts, people who watch it all the time, who follow the UFC and all this stuff. And that's actually not me at all. Like, I never really watched any UFC fights before like a few weeks ago, and wasn't really that interested in the sport itself as a fan. I've always wanted to learn how to fight. So that is – and I always thought that I didn't think that I would have the motivation to just like learn on my own, to just do it, to just like go to classes or to just like start to train and start to spar, like just completely self-motivated. So I wanted to – like I knew that about myself, or I thought that about myself. So I wanted to set up a situation – so that I didn't really have a choice. And committing to like a big money bet sets that up for me, basically. So,
yes.
Yeah.
That makes perfect sense, actually, because typically I've been in this world a while. Typically what happens is you show up at the gym, and then after you've been training for a while, people get the itch and say, "Oh, I'd like to see how I do against the real opponent who's out there, you know, ready to kick my ass." You know that in 6 months, if you don't train, JC is going to kick your ass and take your money. So you're obviously going to be very motivated.
Right. Yeah. So it was. I had this motivation to learn how to fight, which I've had since I was a little kid. I also have been, I've been just getting in better shape, lifting and just training a little bit. But again, I felt like there was a limit to my own motivation. Like, I got in pretty good shape, but I wanted to kind of try to push my body physically to what I thought was its limit, or to as far as I could go. And I wanted to add some sort of external motivation to get to that level. So fitness and fighting were the two things that I really wanted to do. And I felt like a big money bet like this would be a way to ensure that I would follow through and commit.
I just want to quickly ask Olivier one quick question. When you were thinking about this, Olivier, and wanting to set up a fight, I wonder if you thought about different aspects, like could we go boxing or was it going to be MMA? Because, of course, when you bring in MMA, you've got all these different other skill sets that are important that you don't have. You're starting from, you know, raw beginner type thing. And I wonder, did you think about maybe going boxing? Because that's another specific, a very specific one that you could work on for a long period of time.
Yeah, I didn't think about that. And the main reason is because, like, I wanted something as close to a real fight as possible. Because I feel like, you know, this is a sport, but my main goal is not to get good at the sport as much as it is a real life skill. You know, like a real life self-defense, like a fighting skill. So I felt like this version of that would be the closest thing to, like, you know, more than boxing would or kickboxing would or whatever. You know, something with basically as few rules as possible would get me the closest to learning how to, like, fight in a real situation.
So you said you wanted to do this since you were little, but you know, if I understand correctly, you've never actually, well, I'm sure now you have, but you've never set foot in any sort of martial arts gym, MMA gym, nothing like that. So even though you've sort of had this desire, you've never actually acted on it before?
Yeah, I was in Thailand for like a week and I took like a couple Thai boxing classes, but this was like at like some fancy resort with this, like, with just one guy who sure. was training me. So I don't think that really counts. But no, I had never walked into a fight gym. I had never done any real fight based training before I posted on Twitter.
Do you have you done a class now, or are you enjoying it? Do you think you're going to enjoy it?
Yeah, so I've done some, and there are aspects that I enjoy. There are some aspects that I really don't enjoy. And what I'm not sure of yet is whether the things that I don't enjoy are a product of it being so new and will go away as my body adjusts and I get used to this type of thing, or if this is something that will stay with me as I go through this whole process. But again, I don't feel like, I mean, it obviously matters in terms of my enjoyment, but I view this as a thing that I don't have a choice about. So I'm just going to do it regardless of whether I enjoy it or not.
Yeah, you've thrown yourself into the deep end of the pool, so you're going to learn how to swim, or,
yes.
or you're not,
or you're going to drown.
Sounds great. You know, you were an excellent. You know, you mentioned before privately to me that you were a very good track athlete in your youth, and Huxied on Twitter said to me that you're a very athletic guy. Do you have, you know, other sports backgrounds? Do you consider yourself a very good athlete, and you know, do you take that advantage with you?
I mean, I think, you know, again, this that's such a relative term, obviously, right? So, I mean, I think, you know, relative to the poker community, yeah, I think I'm a very good athlete. Relative to, like, the athletic community, like, not really. Yeah, I mean, I've played, like, basketball, like, relatively seriously. I've played tennis relatively seriously. The fact that I was fast made it so that I could kind of get by in a bunch of different sports without having the specific skills required, like lacrosse or soccer or things like that. And I've, you know, and I've gotten a little bit stronger as I've started to lift. But again, like, you know, there are plenty of people who are much more athletically gifted than I am. Just not that many of them play poker.
Olivia, you have a 20-pound weight advantage on JC. And I'm wondering, you know, a lot of people say that's a big deal. I'm not I'm not really an MMA fan. I don't watch it a lot to understand how big of a deal that is. But I'm wondering if it makes a difference with how skilled you are. Like, if you know how to use the 20 pounds, so to speak, or that kind of thing. Terrence, first of all, I want to get your opinion on that, and then maybe Olivia too.
Sure. I mean, when two guys are the same skill level, the guy who weighs 20 pounds more is going to win every time. I've faded 20-pound disadvantages over guys who are less skilled. But, I mean, unfortunately, there's no, like, nice algebraic formula. Like, I haven't been assigned, like, 8 skill points. And if you have, you know, 2.5 more skill points, then you can overcome, like, this many pound disadvantage, unfortunately. Yeah. It would be nice if that worked, but it doesn't. So, I mean, we all know that JC right now has a skill advantage, and Olivier has the strength advantage, and we'll just sort of see 6 months from now how much how much Olivier has overcome the skill advantage. So, but yeah, I'm interested, Olivier, as well as sort of, you know, also is there, you know, any sort of, you know, plan of attack for being the bigger guy?
I mean, at this point, there isn't, just because I don't know anything.
Right.
But I'm sure that I will, like, consider that in terms of, like, when I'm starting to develop, like a strategy for how I want to approach the fight itself. Like, right now, you know, I took a jiu-jitsu class, and I was just, like, submitted six times in a row and, like, 10 minutes by a 130-pound kid. And
I was submitted by a girl on my first day.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, it's – and it was like – you know, and they were like – and you could tell they were also, like, taking it easy. So – and but at the same time, like, I wasn't surprised. I mean, that everyone told me that was going to happen. Like, I knew that was going to happen. And so, you know, it wasn't like – you know, I wasn't shocked by that. But it's still – I mean, you know, there's this obvious kind of humbling feeling, but – but it wasn't that humbling because I didn't come in with an ego. I just know I have an enormous – but my point was just that I have an enormous – and every time, by the way, I started like on top. Like I was never on the bottom throughout the entire class, and I still got submitted every time. So like I, you know, I knew that was going to happen. It was just gave me a little bit more kind of firsthand understanding of how much there is to learn. You know, and like you said about doing something like boxing where there's like kind of a more narrow thing, you know, like – path to go down and could maybe could get better at a smaller number of things that I have to learn. I just have to learn a lot of things, you know, wrestling, grappling, jiu-jitsu, you know, stand striking, all this stuff I have to learn how to do. But I mean, I'm committed to doing it. And again, I'm not fighting. Like people seem to, you know, some people have said to me, they just seem to think that JC is like a seasoned fighter. And like, you know, he hasn't actually fought before. So
that's definitely true. I mean, I've trained with JC. I've done some grappling and some jiu-jitsu, and you know, I think he's competent, but I do think that definitely if you're an athletic guy, and it sounds like you are, even though that term itself, like we just talked about, is super ambiguous, I think you can get to that level. And obviously if you get to his level, then you should win. The question is, do you sort of have the athleticism to get to that level? And nobody knows that. I don't know that. You don't know that. And JC doesn't know that, which is what makes the bet, I think, fun.
Right, right. Yeah, I just think it's, you know, so, because JC has been involved in a bet before, because he has a real interest and passion in MMA, people tend to assume that he's actually done more fighting than he has. So that was like if he had had like three or four fights before – I never would have made this bet, right? I mean, I'm not an idiot. I mean, I'm confident in myself, but I am not, like, blindly arrogant. I think this is, like, a reasonable bet. I think, again, like you said, it depends how seriously I take it and how much better I get. And it also depends how seriously JC takes it, right? I mean, if JC doesn't really train very much, I'll probably be able to catch up and have a really good chance. But if JC and I both train the same amount and we both improve, you know, a lot, he'll still be considerably better than me. And my weight advantage might not really make that much of a difference. So, you know, we'll see. Right now I'm planning on training pretty hard. But you know, it's easy to plan on that when you haven't really done much of it. And it's only the very beginning of a 6-month project.
Olivier, I wonder, you mentioned the different skill sets in MMA fighting, and I wonder if learning a little bit of each one is the way to go, or spending a lot of time on maybe two of them. You know what I mean? Like stand-up fighting and, you know, I mean, I don't know the intricacies, but I wonder if just focusing and becoming really good at one part of it, and Terrence, maybe you can talk about that, might be a better way to approach it.
You want me to go first?
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I want to keep reiterating that I really don't know what I'm talking about. But my sense is that there's like really two major ways, maybe three major ways for this fight to end. That is through submission, that is through like ground and pound, and that is through like a stand-up knockout. I have to learn how to at least defend against submissions, right? I mean, I think his strongest advantage is in jiu-jitsu, and like if I could be dominating a fight and then he could get me in a position where I'm vulnerable and then just win. So like I have to be able to do that. That's like I think the first most important thing that I have to be able to do. And then you know both you know whether it's ground and pound, which I think would probably be something that would be more likely for me to win by just because of my weight advantage, or just a stand up kind of kickboxing route. I mean, I have to learn that too. So you know I'm gonna try to work on as much as I can, and then I'm also just gonna see as I train where I develop more naturally. I might have a more natural, you know, like inclination towards grappling. I doubt that, but I might. my guess is that I'll probably feel more comfortable standing up, punching and kicking, but you know, I'll have a better sense like in 2 months.
I think that's actually a really. I think, you know, for a guy who professes not to know anything, I think that's actually a very intelligent response. There are unfortunately no shortcuts. You do have to sort of get good at everything. You can get surprisingly decent by being a one trick pony to some extent, but if the other person is well rounded, that usually doesn't work that well. And the other thing you said, I think that's very intelligent, is that I think everybody just finds their niche and finds things that they're even good at. And that's not even as wide as, oh, I tend to be better at striking, or I tend to be better at wrestling, or I tend to be better at grappling. Even within that,
right,
even within striking, there's tend to be, oh, I have a good left round kick, or I have this really good sweep from half guard. I've got this good position submission from side control. I'm really good at, you know, a guy like George St. Pierre is good at everything. He's got a great knee tap double leg, you know, that kind of, even within the individual things, there's things that speak to you personally for whatever reason. It is very interesting that way. It's you know, I think it's good. Want to run down a few?
I'm assuming that the same is true for things that you're bad at, right?
Yeah.
I'm assuming you're like, oh,
you're
wow,
vulnerable
whenever
to the
I
same.
Kick with my left leg, like I just, there's no power whatsoever, you know. So I'm assuming you kind of develop niches by being good and by avoiding things that you're weak at.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Just kind of minimizing your weaknesses and making sure your opponent can't take you there. Want to run down just a few of these details. We talked about the money, of course. We're going to do full MMA rules. So, you know, elbows and knees are permitted. You know, the usual MMA rules applies, no eye gouging and no knees to the groin and all that kind of stuff. Four 5-minute rounds with a fifth round of overtime if necessary, which to me seems tremendously grueling. But hey, it's your guys' fight. I'm not going to complain.
I agree. It's tremendous. It seems tremendously grueling. And I agreed to that. Like I think he suggested 3 rounds, and I wanted it to be longer.
Wow.
And that was before. Like that was when I'd really not watched like any fights and had not done any training at all. So I was really just completely like talking out of my ass when I said that. And now that I have a little bit of a better sense, I'm like, wow, like, is this really going to go? Like even professional fighters don't fight for, like, more than 3 rounds most of the time, right?
So I'm That's just, correct.
Yeah, I didn't realize that. I had no idea. So
well, have fun with that. I'll be well. Now, maybe one of you two will get a finish early. But
T, well, hang on one sec. T, I remember your fight. You weren't allowed to ground and pound, right?
Yeah. So I actually had a fight. Because the rules in British Columbia were when one guy is less than 3 fights, you weren't actually allowed to ground and pound to the face.
But can here.
Yeah. So okay. Yeah. I guess it could. There's ways around it. But anyway, I want to get into, you know, you haven't nailed down, so you've nailed, there's a lot of people saying, actually, the first thing I guess I'll get to is there's a lot of people saying, oh, this fight will never happen. You know, you know, these guys, they'll talk, maybe whatever. And part of it maybe stems from the fact that the JC versus Andrew Roble fight never happened.
Yeah.
You guys got some, you know, some bio clauses and postponement clauses, but are you confident that this thing will happen? And where and when would you like it to happen? When the time comes?
Yeah, I mean, so we've basically agreed to do it before Monte Carlo and Scoop. So like basically like mid-April. I want to do it like as late as possible because I want to train more.
Sure.
So I'm not going to do it before then. And I'm pretty sure he's not going to want to do it after then. So that's when we're going to do it. The venue is definitely like a tricky issue. Like he's talked about traveling far away to do the fight, and I do not want to do that. Like I don't want to get on a plane and fly 15 hours to like fight JC Alvarado. Like, I really don't want to do that.
like, Mexico's not that far away.
I could probably say a lot of things before that last line, but one of the things I don't want to do is fly 15 hours first and then do that.
Right.
So I would like to do it as close to home as possible. And there's a number of different avenues that I'm going to try to explore to try to figure out a place to do it. But right now I have no – I can't really shed any light on like how that process
That's going to be tricky, you right? You can't just go, well, we're going to have it in this gym because it's not sanctioned and might be illegal, like the police show. Like what's the problem? What's the issue surrounding where you're going to have this?
I don't even know the answer to that.
Yeah, I don't either. Yeah. I mean, it seems like USA would be out.
There's commissions. I won't get into the minutia about how athletic commissions work. But Olivier, is this a thing where you would like to have like lots of friends and family around? Would you think it was like the coolest thing if it happened like the week before the World Series and you know you had like 500 rabid poker players throwing around huge sums of money? And do you want this to be like a big hype thing, or you know could this happen in a basement in North Dakota for all you care? Like the fight is the fight, and the fight's what matters. Or do you want it to be a big thing or a big deal?
I don't care if it's a big deal. I do not. I will not allow my family to go.
Okay.
A lot of my friends have said that they want to go. Like, that's cool. People want it to be streamed. That's cool. The only way I would really want it to become a major event is if we could monetize it in some additional way. If there's no way to make any more money, I don't have a ton of interest in making this a spectacle. I'm not doing this because I don't like JC Alvarado. I'm not doing this because I want to beat him up. I'm doing this because I want to learn how to fight, and I don't think I'll learn how to fight without this thing at the end. My entire family, first of all, is completely against this. They think it's an absolutely atrocious idea, and it was a very difficult – it was not very difficult, but it was a difficult decision for me to do it, despite all of their admonitions and judgments and all that stuff. But, one of the things that – one of the criticisms that was leveled at me was essentially, why do you want to hurt this person? And I was just and that's obviously from someone who just doesn't have any interest in this world and doesn't really know much about it. But again, I have no interest in hurting JC. It's a product of what we're doing. But that's just that's for me an unfortunate byproduct if one of us
I'm sorry, I'm gonna have to hurt the guy to do whatever.
Yeah, but
I mean,
that's just what we're doing.
That's what happens, yeah.
So anyway, but in terms of people watching it and betting on it and stuff, that's cool. I mean, I think that could be fun. But for me, it's not even secondary, you know. It's way down the list of things that I care about.
Olivier, have you been in a lot of fist fights before? And I'm just curious of this because there's that old famous Tyson quote about everybody's got a plan until you get punched in the face. And it's that realistic or that realizing that you're in a fight. And can I keep it together and, follow my plan type thing? Do you have any kind of experience with this kind of stuff?
I actually used to get in fights a bunch when I was an angry 19, 20, 21 year old. But it wasn't in any sort of organized context. It wasn't in mostly sober contexts.
Right.
And it was a long time ago. And I got into a fight with a kid when I was 24. And we were at some sushi place in New York, and we were both drunk, and he was huge, and we went outside, and his friends were came up to me, his friends separately came up to me, and they were yo, you don't want to do this, this is not a good idea, this guy's crazy. And I was just completely committed and drunk and an idiot, and he bum rushed me, and I hit him, and he fell, and he got right back up and bum rushed me and slammed my head against the cement. And the next thing I know, I was I had him in a headlock. But what I didn't realize was that the thing that was in a headlock was a garbage bag that was on his he was above me, kicking me. And then one of my friends jumped on top of him and like he like separated from me and like I got up and like he got up and we were like looking at each other and everyone was just like, okay, the fight's over. And I was like, wait, what's happening? And there was like blood like rushing down my head and I had to go to the hospital. And that was like the last time I got into any physical altercation with someone. And it was like one of the last times that I got drunk too. And that was, I don't know, like 10 years ago.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, I'm not like, you know, known as the bare knuckle brawler from like Park Avenue in Manhattan. But I have gotten into some fights. I'm actually not at all worried about what's going to happen to me mentally when I get hit in the face. That's okay. Not something I'm worried about. I've heard exactly what you're describing. But I just know myself and I feel like I have a certain level of intensity and focus and, I will train in a way that I am not like blindsided by something, you know. Obviously if JC like catches me, like,
yeah,
he catches me. I mean, that's just what it is, but I'm not going to like, you know, I'm going to try to train in a way that I'm not shocked by what happens.
I'll agree with that. I think it's I think the ability to get hit in the face is very trainable. The ability to get hit in the face by Mike Tyson, maybe not so much. But luckily, he's fighting JC Alvarado and not Mike Tyson. Otherwise, it could go fairly badly. This is a poker show. I guess we'd be a little bit remiss if we didn't ask you about, you know, the poker that you're
about
playing.
About DFS? No, sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, if you're going to play some online or live or whether, you know, it's just going to be full-time training and the only, you know, you're going to be like Rocky in the basement with JC's poster on your heavy bag. And that's all you're going to be doing.
No. I'm going to play a lot of poker. Okay. Yeah, I'm going to be playing a lot of poker online and then I'm going to be traveling around too. I might not take as many cross the ocean trips just because jet lag tends to affect me a bunch and I get like tired and lose weight and rarely like train or do anything when I'm traveling to Europe. So I might like skip Prague, for example. I'm not going to go to Malta. But I'll play a bunch of American tournaments. I'm going to play Bellagio. I'm going to PCA. I'm going to play some other stuff. I'm going to play a bunch online. I'm still, you know, a professional poker player more than I am anything else. This is a project of mine that I'm committed to for 6 months and, you know, want to be as prepared as I can for, but I'm not going to completely reorient my life.
All right. Well, once again, so that's $150,000 on the line, you know, that Olivier stands to win, or $120,000 that he stands to lose. Olivier, if you win, you will have made 6 times more money in your MMA debut than Sage Northcutt did for his recent UFC fight. I don't know
which
if you knew that.
Which means nothing to
if
me,
you win,
Olivier.
It's 6 times more than Sage Northcutt got paid.
Is that including the 20% bonus he got for the guy?
No, you did. Oh. You did know. You did nail that. He did get a performance of the night bonus for that knockout, but his official paycheck, something like 24,000 or something like that.
Wow.
Sage, I know you're a fan of his, so I figured I'd give you
that. Pretty good. Yeah. I like watching him. He's such a nice, humble kid, you know?
He is a good kid. It's a cool video of him doing front flips at the gym in Montreal this week. Olivier, thanks for taking the time out of both your poker and your training schedule. You've got a lot of both to do. I wish you guys both luck. I hope you both stay healthy. I have to say I speak for the poker world when I say I'm excited to see this and then hope you guys put on a good fight.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Thanks for taking the interest. And I don't know if I answered one of your questions directly in terms of whether I expect this fight to happen. But we specifically made the buyout clause very, very high on purpose because we wanted to make sure that this fight did happen. So I'm very, very confident that this thing actually will go down.
Well, okay, and maybe if somebody out there wants to make a side bet, we can establish a line on the meta fight. Will this fight actually happen? Maybe.
Good idea.
You've already got enough action on the fight, so I don't know if you need more, but maybe more lines can never be a bad thing for the poker community. I always think we always appreciate and support each other degenning it up against each other.
For sure.
Olivier, thanks so much. Thanks a lot for your time. Have a good one.
All right, thank you guys. Take care.
Wow, that's interesting, T. My first thought is if it was me and I had 6 months to learn everything about MMA because I had a giant fight on the line, I'm not doing anything else. I'm not traveling. I'm not playing poker. I'm in the gym or training or doing whatever it is as much as I can.
But it is really hard because, you know, I mean, you could try to train 5 hours a day, but most people's bodies, especially if you've never done any MMA training, they're just not up to that, right?
No, I guess like, studying more than that too, like just watching fights, like getting somebody that knows what they're doing.
That really surprises me that the guy hadn't really even watched any MMA fights up until a couple of weeks ago. That's sort of the thing that blows my mind for a guy who's always been interested in self-defense and fighting. Like that's the thing. Like this UFC, it's hard to ignore. I mean, people who aren't fans at all have watched a UFC.
Like, right? I don't even know how you would approach it. Like, let's say I did this, and I say, okay, T, can you just sit with me for 6 months, and we'll watch, and you'll train, and you'll train me, and I'll pay you whatever. So you and I are sitting watching a fight, and I go, okay, well, pause it. Let's watch what that guy just did right there. Okay, let's go to the mat. Show me what he just did.
Absolutely.
Okay, so that one move would take me a week to master. Never mind. Okay, start it again. Now, oh, he did another one. Okay, jump over to the mat. Like, you're going to forget. That's what I mean. Like, 6 months is almost
no time.
No, I think
you're absolutely right. That's a really good point. And you see this a lot with professional fighters who get injured, right? So a lot of the smart ones, they'll just be in the gym, not training. They'll watch the moves being taken and thrown down, or you know, like you said, to watch a video. I think actually the best one of the things that you can do is literally just show up to the gym and not expecting a train, but you just watch the moves being moved and watch people sparring against each other and how they do. And yeah, I guess you're kind of right, and maybe that speaks to some of the ignorance that Olivier has, something that he doesn't quite understand it, that there are all these options to be able to watch fight videos, or to sit down with a coach, or to go in the gym even when you're tired and not ready to train. You're right. You're absolutely right. Like maybe even if you can't train 4 or 5 hours a day, you could still be 8 hours, 9 hours a day studying this stuff.
Yeah, you
actually make a really good point.
You could train 4 hours and then study for 4 hours. I mean, that's what I'd be doing. I think,
you're totally right. You're totally right. And it is surprising because I think in the poker world, I think Olivier is the kind of guy who would understand this, because how else, you know, he's one of the most successful players in modern history, to be perfectly honest. So, he's certainly done his studying away from the table.
Maybe he's throwing us for a loop and he's misinformation.
Could be the most epic sandbag ever, and he's going to come out and just throw like flying ninja kicks and do like a 720 knockout of moves that nobody's ever seen before.
You're in a unique situation. You're friends with JC. You've now heard Olivier talk about his preparation. I want to get your take on the line, what you think of the line, and who would you bet on given that line?
It's still so hard because, you know, like the Olivier that, you know, even if today I instead of doing this interview, I was in New York City and I laced up the gloves with Olivier, I still wouldn't know anything, right? Because, you know, yeah, Olivier would suck today and he'll suck tomorrow and he'll suck next week and he'll suck 3 weeks from now, but I don't know how much he'll suck 2 months from now, and I don't know how much he'll suck 4 months from now, and certainly 6 months from now is so hard because I've trained with guys who are just athletic freaks, and that's why I keep asking this question and why he has, you know, a hard time answering. I've trained with these guys and they've only been training for 6 months, and I'm like, I cannot believe you've only been training for 6 months. You're doing stuff that I couldn't do after 3 years. I know where JC's level is. I mean, he's competent. He's all right. I mean, I think he's probably ready for like an amateur level fight on the regional scene. But you know, I don't expect him to be a pro level fighter. He's definitely not a pro level fighter. But the thing is, I'm comparing like one known quantity against something that's completely known. And that's Olivier Busquet 6 months from now, and I just don't know enough about it. I'm inclined to bet JC on the current line, like, so it's, I guess it comes out to what, -125, is that right?
Something like that.
120 to win 150. So it's 125. I guess I would bet JC right now, but there's so many mysteries. I would not be willing to make a huge bet on this unless I literally showed up at Olivier's gym a week before the fight and showed up at JC's gym like a week before the fight and I watched them both spar, and then I would bet like a ton of money on one of those two guys,
right?
Because I feel like I could definitely be knowledgeable enough. But people keep asking me for my opinion on this. I'm like, I don't know. There's just you got one guy that's just a huge question mark. If he's a great athlete, he'll be a favorite. If he's just an okay athlete, he's probably a dog.
What now if you're JC? I mean, he's, like you say, he's competent, he's ready for an amateur level fight. What would you say JC should try? What's his approach when he's fighting this unknown quantity? Like, does he go and work on parts of his game that aren't very good, or strengthen up the game, the parts that are?
I think, yeah, I mean, I think, you know, you should always, I think you should probably push his advantage in this way. Whether he thinks that striking or grappling or something, that might be a question for him if we had a chance to have him on. But I think I as the small guy game plan, I think is just footwork. It's just footwork, footwork, footwork. And I think that is, he'll have an advantage on that right now because of boxing training and because of grappling training, is that he'll just be quicker and faster. He'll be more coordinated. And so he should definitely still carry that advantage in. And it's the most important thing for him as the smaller guy, because as the smaller guy, you always want to make the bigger guy chase you, tire himself out. And especially, this is a I can't believe that this is 5 5-minute rounds. That's nuts. I think that part of it definitely favors JC.
It's 4 or 5 minute rounds, and then maybe an extra round.
A fifth if there's an overtime. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, it could be 3-1. But yeah, I guess it could be if somebody wins the first three, then the other guy has to knock him out in the fourth. But the advantage should be like a cardio one and a footwork one, and his whole game plan should probably just involve around Olivier tiring himself out. Olivier's part for his game plan, it should probably involve you know, in the striking game, you know, hitting him with power shots, trying to finish him, or in the ground game, like getting on top, getting dominant positions, and taking away that gas tank advantage, because it's very tiring to have somebody heavy on top of you for a long time.
All right, we will try and have JC on and at some point before the fight. Hopefully, he takes.
See how
down
he's
this
doing in the main, by the way.
Yeah, I just refreshed it. He is.
Oh, he's third.
Oh, he bumped up. He looked like he tripled up.
Wow.
You know, nice. And I didn't even think about this, but I guess Olivier is cheering for JC to win this tournament so that, you know, he's just less motivated. I mean, if he just wins all the money while he's away in Berlin and Malta, maybe he won't train as hard.
So true, right?
I thought he wanted him to win so he could guaranteed to get paid.
Yes. He'll get paid, I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm sure he's getting paid.
All right. Let's move on from the MMA cast back to the poker cast. Let's bring in our next guest. This is a fellow by the name of Ryan Spittles. He's a professional poker player and presenter for Sky Poker in the UK. He's currently on a trip through the US. Let's bring him in now. Welcome to the poker cast, Ryan.
Yeah, thanks for the invite. Good to be here.
Ah, no problem. I mentioned that you are an analyst for Sky Poker, and for those of us in North America don't understand 100% what exactly Sky Poker is, can you first of all tell us what I understand it's a site, but also television as well?
Yeah, so Sky is kind of like ESPN here.
Okay.
And they mainly focus on football coverage and you know, satellite TV. They have a betting site, poker site, kind of a mix, and it also has a TV. Well, it had a TV channel, 24/7 TV channel. It still has a live TV show that takes place on Sky Sports. So it's got quite a large following and good viewing figures, and kind of the remit is to educate about poker, but also to entertain. So it's a good mix.
So Terrence, this is what happens when there's a reasonable government that allows a online poker site to be owned by a television channel, and the marketing possibilities are endless. That's fantastic. Can you give us
the poker's evil and corrupts youth?
Yeah, exactly. Give us an idea, Ryan. So you're an analyst for Sky Poker. You do some of the television and talk about hands, break down hands. Can you give us an idea how that job came about? You're a professional poker player, and imagine a lot of people would love to have that job.
Yeah, it kind of came out of nowhere. So I started playing poker, you know, like most people, and from watching rounders and just making a small deposit, lost for a long time. And then I started playing on Sky Poker, and I was still a losing player. And I kind of was watching the TV channel that they had. I was reading the forums, and, you know, I progressed my way up through the site. They had a sponsorship deal, which was for kind of UK live tournaments. And there was a group of about six or seven of us that went out into live tournaments with a patch, and we wrote blogs and kind of other stuff as well. And they asked us all on as a guest for the TV show. And I went as the guest, and it came about that the whole reason for doing this was to get two new analysts for the show. So I said that, that they told me that I was well received, and I did that about 4 years ago now, and I've been on it ever since.
Did it come naturally? I mean, television commentating, you know, everybody thinks they can jump on there and no problem. Yeah. I can talk about hands, but it's not that easy, right?
Yeah, definitely. It's live TV, and it was definitely hard to get used to. The really good thing is that, you know, the hosts are really professional. Really, they should be doing better, you know, more viewed shows than a poker show. And, you know, it was really hard to get used to, but, you know, when you're talking about poker as a poker player, it kind of goes into autopilot mode. And after a while you forget that thousands of people are watching you. So, yeah, it's definitely been a learning curve, but it's been a great experience.
Now, poker in the UK is, I mean, it's got a lot, poker on television specifically in the UK has a much greater history than poker television in the United States. Do you find the audience is more sophisticated at all because of this, or do you think it's different? I mean, I'm sure you've watched the ESPN Poker and World Poker Tour and all the American shows. Is your level of commentary different because televised poker has more a lengthier history in England?
Well, the Sky Poker shows, the reason for it being is mainly to sell the site and get people to sign up to Sky Poker. But yeah, I would say that it is a bit different. I would say that certain stuff that I've seen from just being in America for a couple of months and you know, turning on the TV, there does seem to be a bit more of a gimmick to it. But yeah, I mean, America is the home of poker. It's really sad that there aren't, you know, so much more devoted to poker. And I've been traveling around the US for a couple of months now. And the thing that strikes me is that, you know, you think that poker is big in England and the UK, considering how far it's come in the last, say, 5 to 6 years. But it's nothing compared to America. It is like a sport here.
Yeah, I want to just quickly ask you another question about commentating. And as a poker commentator, it's sometimes difficult because, you know, you can analyze situation, you can analyze hands, and, you know, you can you're very rarely analyzing a hand where there's an easy right decision. But there's a lot of times when there's a whole bunch of really bad decisions, right? So if you're commentating and you kind of suggest one of the bad lines or something like that, that's the part that always would make me afraid. Like, oh, I blow this hand and everybody's going to think I'm an idiot.
Yeah, it's a fine line. I mean, I'm always kind of careful not to go too far. The thing about Sky Poker is that it's a relatively small site compared to Pokerstars. You know, at peak there might be, say, 5,000 people on the site, the whole of the site, and a lot of the regulars I actually know by name and I'm friends with, and I also play on the site and I play with them day in, day out. So, you know, criticizing those guys, it's actually easier because, you know, that they know who I am, they know that I'm not being malicious. I have had quite a few times people sending me kind of messages on Twitter going, what do you know about that? You know, I won the hand.
Yeah.
You know, why are you saying that I played this wrong? I won the hand. Doing that. But you know, it's generally people realize that you're there to kind of help. And also they realize that just because I'm a commentator, just because I'm analyzing, doesn't mean that I'm a perfect poker player. I'm making, you know, nearly as many mistakes as a lot of the other guys out there. The great thing about poker is that, you know, every hand is different. So much is, you know, read dependent. And, you know, when I'm on Sky Poker, I'm going into a table where these guys have been playing for hours and I'm just looking at a specific hand. So you also have to realize, you know, what's gone on half an hour before. Is this guy bluffing or et cetera?
So there's been a lot of discussion here in North America with the World Series of Poker main event coverage and how it kind of morphed into more strategy talk. And people wanted that to begin with. And then when it arrived, everybody went, wait a second, this is turning people off. So there's this movement away from it, or this, you know, people would like to see less of strategy. I mean, but it seems like in England or in the UK, there's sort of more of a focus when I watch the EPT or the Sky Poker clips I've seen. There's a lot of discussion about strategy, and I wanted to get your take on sort of the difference of those two outlooks.
Yeah, I mean, I think the World Series coverage is excellent. I think the guys that run it and the production values are great as well. I think there's always got to be a mix between, you know, entertaining, having someone like Norman there with his one-liners and his jokes, and equally there's also room for someone like Olivier Busquet coming in with the more technical side. But yeah, I think the product that the ESPN produces is excellent. But yeah, I mean, I would say that there maybe is more of a strategy side towards the EPT, and that is because the EPT is marketing it as for PokerStars. So therefore, they want people to kind of get better, because the better that the players are, the more chance they have to kind of hold their own, and the more they hold their own, the rake will eventually go around, and PokerStars will actually get more money from it. ESPN, they have a completely different kind of job to do, because it's an entertainment show, but they don't have a poker site to go, look, we want players to get better. We want to focus on, say, sit and go strategy today or cash game strategy today. So they don't have that. Whereas PokerStars are obviously going to be more mindful of you know, ultimately it is an advert for driving people towards PokerStars.
I wonder if doing this and doing the television and breaking down hands, do you think, and you know, different people, do you think it's improved your game at all?
Definitely. You know, a few years ago when I first started the show, I was still playing, you know, relatively small stakes. I'm still a relatively small stakes player, but when I started on the show, I wasn't really playing many live tournaments. Since then, I've played probably 100 or so tournaments in the, say, $1,500 region. And it's definitely pushed me on forward. You know, when you are known, you don't want to look silly. So it's definitely driven me to get better.
You've had some good results on some of those multi-table tournaments, live ones you were talking about, specifically on the UK IPT. And we hear a lot about that tour over here. We see a lot of press results, and I want to get your take on what you think of that specific tour.
Yeah, it's a great tour. We're really lucky in the UK because the market is really competitive. But I think also we're kind of lucky because of the geography of the UK, where no matter where you are, it's still relatively easy to get to a tournament. Whereas in the US, there's so much more traveling involved.
Right.
So yeah, that's the reason why it's competitive. We have a guy called Rob Young who runs Dusk Till Dawn, the biggest poker club in Europe, and he's kind of raised the stakes for everyone. The UK IPT regularly goes to his club as well. But yeah, I mean, I think we're really lucky to have such a thriving market, and the UK IPT, they've been there for years now. It's a shame they don't do the TV coverage, because the first couple of years we had an EPT style show for that, and that was a great show. But it's definitely I would say if you were to ask any poker player what they would want to win in the UK, it would be UK IPT. It is the most prestigious tour.
Wow.
Going there, and that's also because of the players. You know, it's Poker Stars and the satellite qualifiers that they go there and they play there, and the tour is more competitive. And you kind of do see a bit of a change in the demographic between the tours. There's not much difference in the buy-in between the GUKPT, which is run by Grosvenor Casinos, and they're going around the country as well. Similar kind of buy-ins. But if there's a satellite player on your table there, they're more likely to want it through a live satellite than their online satellite. And it definitely changes the makeup of the tour.
Nice. Before we move on to your USA trip, I just want to get your take on the online poker climate in Europe and in the UK. Can you give us an idea of some of the different sites, networks, and your general impressions of each of the stuff available for you guys?
Yeah, of course, Pokerstars, it's huge everywhere. Sure. Party Poker, they've recently done something really interesting where they're going to ban HUDs, which you know, is really, I think it's positive for the site. We have 888, which is really impressive with some of the guarantees they have on their tournaments. iPoker as well, and then we have a load of small sites. So we have Sky Poker, we have Unibet, which is on their own network. The market is, there's still a lot of opportunity there. There's a lot of choice, but like anywhere, it is dominated by PokerStars.
It's interesting when you have a market like that where you can thrive as a smaller site. You create all those secondary choices here, you know, in a lot of environments. You know, Stars still dominates there, and Stars is going to dominate elsewhere. But when you have a government that cooperates with somebody like Sky Poker, and you can build a second tier site, or you know, who knows what could happen, it's really healthy for the environment, right?
Yeah, I mean, Sky Poker has been really successful, and when it launched, it did some things different to other sites. So it's never allowed the use of HUDs and tracking software. And, you know, we're now seeing that other sites are coming across to that way of thinking. And of course, the TV channel helped. It's got a forum, which no other poker site that I know has, mainly because poker players like to moan whenever they get bad beats.
Sure, yeah.
But also, it's kind of developed the community, and we regularly have players all over the country that will meet up, go to local casinos, and you put a name to a face, or a face to a name.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's definitely a tight-knit community. Of course, it's UK only, which in a way kind of helps, because that is, you know, being able to play in pounds. Is a big thing for a lot of people. You know, players do like to kind of put a value to their money. So yeah, there's a lot of positives to having a smaller site. The UK government recently they've done some things with the gambling industry. There's a French site which I used to play on called Winamax, mm-hmm. and because of changes, that was no longer available to me. But yeah, I mean, I personally think that for the poker industry to thrive, we need kind of a global pool. We need governments to come together. But realistically, that's never going to happen. When you can see what's happening in the US, you're never going to get, you know, countries like France and Spain and Italy agreeing to a global pool after, you know, segregating it themselves. So it's quite sad in that way.
We've mentioned your tour of the U.S., Ryan. Mm-hmm. I want to get your what was the idea? What was the inspiration for this? Had you spent some time in the U.S. or you thought, you know what, I'm going to go over there and play poker all over the place?
Yeah, I've been to Vegas, I think, 6 times now.
Oh, okay.
For this World Series. And this year I spent 2 months there. And last year I also spent 3 weeks in Florida. The games are really good here. But
you're in Fort Lauderdale, yeah.
Yeah. But also it was kind of like, I'm 28 now. You know, you're getting to that point where I've been playing for a living for 6 or 7 years. And, you know, you kind of think, how long will this last? And the great thing about poker is that, playing for a living is the flexibility it gives you. And realistically, I'm not going to have that flexibility for much longer. So me and my friend Sin Mellon, we decided to come out on a tour of the US. And the plan was to play some poker for a few days a week and then do some traveling and see some sites, etc. It's gone a bit different to that. But yeah, I mean, I would definitely do things a bit differently if I could do it again. And even though the poker hasn't gone great, I will be back.
Where have you been? Where have you played?
Yeah, so we started out in Philadelphia, and within, I think, an hour of the airport, we were at a casino, the Parts Casino. Great, great place they've got up there. A lot of action. Yeah, then we spent quite a long time in Atlantic City. Then we took some time off from poker, so we was in, just drove through Delaware and Maryland. We went to Washington, D.C., played at Maryland Live, another great casino, and then from there down to Florida, took our time and down to Florida.
So you've just been in a rental car the whole time, just traveling the entire East Coast, playing poker?
Yeah,
very cool. It's a very, very old, you know, it reminds me of my old friend Gavin Griffin, who used to travel in an RV and just play in games all over the U.S. It's you know, you're just on the road, stop at a casino, take some of the locals' money and move on to the next stop.
Yeah, except it's happened where the locals have taken my money. That's true. But no, we rented a big SUV. So yeah, that was good. Also a tip. Because I've rented cars in Vegas before, and I'm quite kind of like an organized person, so I like to pay for it up front and get everything sorted. So I didn't pay for it up front this time, and I kind of used the accent at the girl on the check-in desk at the rental car company, and I was meant to have a standard SUV, which was like $2,800 for 2 months.
Wow!
And I got like the biggest SUV they've got. A Chevrolet Suburban, and because I was nice to the check-in girl, she did something on the computer and got it for $1,800 for 2 months.
Wow.
So like within landing, I was already 1K up. So,
American girls are suckers for the UK accent, for the British accent.
Exactly. So yeah, don't pay for the rental car before you get there. Always make sure you leave the option to get a bargain.
I want to get your take on the differences. Obviously, you've played a bunch of live poker now in the U.S. And also back in the U.K. What do you notice are the major differences between the players this side of the pond and the other side?
There's so much many more of you. You know, it's incredible to see how many poker players there are. It's like it's in American blood. Yeah, so that's the main thing. The games are run really good here. The dealers are a high standard. You know, things like having chips at the table and the ability to buy chips at the table just keeps the game running smoother and faster. In the UK, you can't buy chips at the table, so therefore it's just something that just adds to the process, which is necessary. I think as a whole, the promotions are good. Like we all know that having to pay a dollar per hand towards a high hand is generally going to be a bad thing. You're not going to win it enough to kind of make it back. But, you know, so many players talk about these promotions and it does keep them at the table. And also it just means that they're talking about something. And so often in the two months I've heard, you know, discussion to dealer, some banter about, oh, if you get the high hand, I'll give you $50. I think that's a really good thing. Where, you know, I personally know that paying a dollar every hand that I win is bad because I'm going to win more pots than most people. But I think for the general health of the games, it's a good thing. It's just something that adds to it. I think the overall age of poker players in the US is a lot older. In the UK, I'm 28 and quite often I'll be, you know, kind of the middle-aged guy at the table, whereas here I'm often the youngest. But yeah, the games are good here. One thing that kind of annoys me about the games is that I mainly play 2-5, and the buy-in levels. So it's generally 200 to 500, and that's taken some adjustment to. Because in the UK, it's kind of either uncapped or I think 300 big blinds is generally the minimum. But yeah, I mean, it's a great place to play poker. There's a lot of action. And, you know, being able to go to so many different casinos and meet so many interesting people, that's what I'm really thankful for.
One thing I wanted to ask you, and you sort of alluded to this slightly, but one thing that turns off a lot of Europeans and British when they go to the U.S. is the sort of the tipping culture, and I think nowhere is that more prevalent than the casino. You know, you mentioned being able to buy chips at the table. Kind of, you kind of often have to tip everybody when you're at a casino in the United States. Is that been bothersome at all, or you've just been around long enough that it's not a big deal, or do you have a sort of more British attitude towards it?
No, the thing that I love about the US is the tipping culture. And I think it's a really good thing because it incentivizes good service. And that's why dealers tend to be better here. Also, you guys tend to moan about the rake. So the rake generally is going to be $5 max. In the UK, it will be £10 max, which is like $15.
Wow.
I've played places in Europe where it's uncapped. There was one in France where I won a 4,000 euro pot and it was 4% uncapped. So it's 160 euros. And I was in seat 10 and they have like a little calculator to the right of the dealer. So for the next hand, I saw 160 euros on this little calculator thing
right
in front of me, like literally down the drain. So never moan about rake here. Like the dealers are so much better. You know, back home tips are shared. So quite often in poker, you'll tip the dealer still, but you know that dealer's only getting a tiny percentage of that. I far prefer it here. You know, and it promotes good service. The only thing that I won't tip for though is when I'm in Vegas and those guys open the cab door. That is like that's the only
pure
one
hustle.
Yeah,
or the door.
You know, fair enough if they're putting my bag in the back, but for opening the door and telling the guy, oh, you're going to the Bellagio, no, it's not worth it.
And the guy opening the front door to the casino, like with his hand up. What about the games? Like, are they much better here? Or are they looser? Do you think?
Yeah, you can get really tight games here, but generally they're better, especially in a place like Florida, where a lot of the players are obviously just here to pass the time. I've spent a lot of time at the Palm Beach Kennel Club, and because I've been grinding a lot, I've kind of been getting there at 10 o'clock in the morning. It's been like a normal job, and you'll see guys coming in and that's what they do for their day. You know, that to get away from the wife, they come and play poker for 6 hours. They're retired, and therefore they don't mind if during those 6 hours they might lose $100 or whatever. It doesn't matter to them. The games are good. People are friendly. And, the great thing is the availability of the games, even in a city like London. Because we don't have poker in our blood, and you know it's kind of only boomed since online poker and TV poker, whereas I would imagine still pre online boom days there would be a lot more games in a place like Atlantic City than there is currently now in London, simply because of the volume of you guys and how much you guys love poker.
I saw that. You mentioned you played you were in Vegas for 2 months for the World Series this year. I saw on Twitter that you did play the main event. Was that the first time you played the main?
No, it was the fourth time.
Oh wow! Okay, great.
Still haven't cashed yet. It's the main event. It's always that weird thing. So I can kind of where every single pot you win or lose. Like, even if it's only a couple hundred chips, it matters so much.
Right.
Like, it really does.
Yeah.
I remember winning so many pots and losing so many pots this year. And, I guess maybe it's because I've played so many tournaments now, you kind of become numb to it. So, you know, you get in a flip and then say $1,000 tournament. And because you've done it so many times, it's just normal now.
Yeah.
But surely a guy that mainly plays $50 tournaments and he somehow satellite into a $1,000 tournament, maybe that's the same feeling he gets.
Probably.
It's unique. I love the main event. Lots of people say bad things about the Rio, but every time when you at the World Series, you know, walking into the World Series and hearing the music, it's just something that's really exciting. And hopefully I'll be able to play it for a few more years to come.
Well, hopefully we run into you down there next year. What's our buddy Channing up to these days? Is he semi-retired now? He's getting so old.
Yeah, Neil. Well, he does everything, doesn't he? You know, he's the Sky Poker ambassador, so he's doing a lot of the Sky Poker TV stuff now as well. But yeah, Neil Channing, a legend in UK poker. You know, won so much and done so much for the game. And also in the betting industry as well. You know, he's sure. I hope he writes a book one day. I really hope he does.
BettingEmporium.com is his site. He won't come on the show anymore. Last time he was on, he demanded payment. He needs to be paid to come on. Yeah.
He's got so much money though. Why does he need it?
Indeed. No, just kidding. He's one of our favorite guests. Thanks so much, Ryan. Really appreciate your time. Good luck if you're going to stay, and if you're heading back, good luck back at home, and we will talk to you soon.
Yeah, thanks a lot, guys. Have a good show.
Thanks, Ryan.
Thank you. Cheers. Great talking to you.
Oh, that was great. Get a Brit perspective on poker here in the U.S., Terrence. I always found games to be friendlier.
So you're doing it too. So he thought we were American, which is very forgivable because sure. You know, we have these accents that don't sound that different from American accents.
I called him a Brit.
But now you're saying
he's a Brit
here in the U.S.
Oh, did I say here in the... Sorry, here in North America, yes.
We're here in North America. I could definitely... I understand that he doesn't know where we're from, but you should know where
I should know that. All right.
But yeah, it was interesting. He's absolutely right, too, about, of course, the World Series main event. It is always special, no matter how jaded you get. It's the main event rules.
Indeed. All right, we're coming up on a longer show, so we might cut out a few things from the next segment, but we'll get to... out to the Isle of Man, and we'll talk about some hands from Rossco Report this week, I believe, and get to some more email or two, hopefully. You're listening to the 2+2 PokerCast, presented by the Pokerstars VIP Club. More right after this.
At the 800 table, UTG min raises to 8K with 32 big blind effective. Cutoff calls with 70 big blinds, and I call with 10-9 of spades on the button with a stack of 400K. Bull blinds fold. Flop comes Jack 8-6 rainbow with one spade. UTG bets 14K, cutoff calls, and I overcall. The turn is the ace of spade, giving me a flush draw. UTG keeps on betting, 32K this time. Cutoff calls again, and I raise to 90K. After tanking for a few minutes, UTG lets it go. Cutoff takes even longer before folding too.
Team Pro Online's Marc-Andre French Dog Ladouceur is a Supernova Elite VIP. This is the 2+2 PokerCast, presented by the Pokerstars VIP Club.
Hi guys, it's Mike from ProfessionalPoker.com and the 2+2 store with some great news for our Pokerstars players. You can now use your frequent player points to purchase gift cards available from ProfessionalPoker.com. These same cards will also work at the 2+2 store. The gift cards come in increments of $25 and $50, and you can apply multiple gift cards per order. Now you can get the books, videos, and ebooks from all the major publishers using just your FPPs. So check out the gift card section of the PokerStars FPP store and pick up the poker training material you've had your eye on for a while at the 2+2 store and ProfessionalPoker.com.
Okay, people. Most of the kittens have perished. There are a few left you can save, though, and here's how to do it. Get involved with the PokerCast by emailing your questions, suggestions for the show, or even record a sound clip. Adam will be using the best ones on the air. Well, let's face it, probably the worst ones as well. I can see you there at your computer. Send an email right now. Totally disagree with one of Adam's takes last week? Send an email. Love last week's interview? Email. Want to know how much cash Adam has on him right now? Email. Pokercast@2plus2.com is the address. Ship the funny to Adam today. Hey, folks, don't forget to follow the PokerCast crew on Twitter. Adam is @PokerCastAdam, and he'll keep you up to date on things like upcoming guests, listener contests, and all the latest bacon-related food innovations. Follow Ross at PokerCastRoss, and you'll discover new hip-hop bands and learn how to not play Micro Stakes No Limit. Also, give us a like on Facebook, where we post lots of photos and other nonsense.
This week on the Under the Gun podcast, hosted by David Tuckman, Chris Grobe from the Online Poker Report talks about the legality of daily fantasy sports.
it's really rapidly moving story, and some of these things are getting written in a hurry. The second is there's sort of a vacuum of competing information. You didn't really have the major sites out there telling the story. I didn't necessarily see the FSTA stepping forward and filling that vacuum. So in the absence of competing information, you're certainly going to run into a situation where, yeah, sometimes the path of least resistance is going to be, you know, what's taken by the media. But
check out the End of the Gun podcast every Wednesday night at 6 p.m. Pacific time on twitch.tv/tuckonsports or on crushlivepoker.com.
And it starts sometime around midnight, or at least that's when you lose yourself for a minute or two. As you stand under the bar lights and the band.
Welcome back to the 2+2 Pokercast, presented by the Pokerstars VIP Club. Speaking of Pokerstars, let's head out to the Isle of Man and talk to our good friend, Mr. Matthew Hilger. Matthew, welcome back to the Pokercast.
Thank you very much. How are you guys?
Fantastic, sir. I see PokerStars is celebrating the first anniversary of the Spin and Goes by bringing back the $1 million Spin and Go jackpots. Matthew, could PokerStars, do you think, have guessed how successful the Spin and Go format was going to turn out a year ago? I mean, it's just probably exceeded all expectations.
I mean, it truly is a game changer. We knew it was... Obviously, we knew it was going to be big, but we didn't know how big. And it's just, by all accounts, a huge success. It's a major driver of our TV campaigns. We found, you know, when we're advertising Spin and Goes, they have a much better, success rate than just the normal PokerStars type of advertisement. Players love them. You know, they're a lot of fun. They're just a lot of fun, and they're addictive.
Yeah. You mentioned that it's a major force in your advertising. Do you think it's sort of a gateway for new players to Spin and Goes, to tournament poker, to cash game poker? I mean, do you think it's one of those things that people, when they first come on PokerStars and they try them, it helps sort of ease in their conversion to playing different games on the site?
Yes, I wish I had the exact stats to quote you. I don't, but I can say what you said is very true. Players come to the site, they play Spin and Goes, and we find many of them play different game types even in their first month. They branch out and they start playing other games.
Yeah, I know there's a lot of people who say, or there are some people that say, it takes away from the Sit and Goes, and I think it probably does take away some traffic from Sit and Goes as well. But the overall positive of having these people come in, have fun their first time there, instead of, you know, maybe not enjoying it as much as they would with a Spin and Go, maybe getting lucky and hitting a 10 times multiplier or something, keeps them sort of engaged, and the overall good is what we're after there.
It's just like any industry. You have to innovate. You have to offer new products. And this is, you know, it's a new way of playing poker, and the players have responded. And, you know, you have to listen to what the players like. It's obviously, it's an exciting form of poker. Players love it. By all accounts, I mean, every measure of success, it works. It drives players to the site. We get players here, and then they get to start playing other games. So it's, you know, I've played them on the, you know, on competitor sites. I play them, and they're great fun. I love tournaments, but tournaments take such a time commitment, and it's so much fun to be able to sit down. And, you know, if you have 15, 20, 25 minutes, you can play a few of these things, and you still have a chance at winning some nice money. And so they're just a lot of fun. And I think it's there's also, I think, some misperceptions out there in terms of the skill level. You know, most people think of this as a recreational product, but there are still plenty of players out there that are grinding these. They're playing this a massive number of these. So there are people out there, you know, playing these professionally. You know, there's good value there. I think it's good for everybody all around.
I mentioned
one of the more interesting things, Adam, is that it's also a really big social media win too, the Spin and Go. One of the coolest things that I think about this is that you can actually people will post their own Spin and Go wins up on like YouTube and stuff like that. And I'm sure there are people out there who are Twitch streaming their Spin and Goes. I haven't encountered that too much myself, but the fact is, like, if you just type like Spin and Go into Google or into YouTube, you actually see these people with like their 1K win, and they're publishing it, their 1K win that they bought in for a dollar, and it's 1K or 3K or whatever it is, because it's that opportunity. Well, you just wouldn't get that with a regular Spin and Go, because who's going to – why are you so – you know, you're not going to be that excited when you 3X your buy-in. So I just thought there's sort of like an interesting social media aspect as well of Spin and Go that's sort of like free advertising for you guys.
Exactly, and – if you hit a big MTT, who's going to sit there and watch for several hours, right?
Yeah.
So that's the other beauty is, you know, you can post this thing and your friends can, you know, they can watch for 10 minutes and see what happens. So, yeah, I mean, it's a great product. By all accounts, it's been very successful, and we launched these 1 year ago, and we had 5 millionaires so far this year, and then we hit another one today. So was kind of exciting for us right at the beginning of this big promotion that we're running.
Speaking of broadcasting the Spin and Goes, Jamie Staples, I think, even he noticed that when he was streaming and he brought up the big multiplier Spin and Goes and then made a YouTube video of it, he hit like 500K views.
Really?
Yeah, he's got like a ton of views on just him streaming the big multipliers.
That was fantastic. I mean, that was one of the first twitching streams that I watched of Jamie. And I mean, he's just playing his game and he got so into it and it was so exciting. You know, it's exciting. I mean, there's nothing like this in poker. You're sitting there, you're just playing, you're getting two X's, you're getting two X's. And then all of a sudden you're playing for $1 million. I can't remember how much time we give you, but you have 1 or 2 minutes to sit there and prepare, and then you're playing for $1 million, and you know, second and third place you get 100K, so it's like it's a huge difference. And you compare that to a tournament, when you make a final table, you've built up to it, you're in 20th place and you're like, wow, I might make the final table and I might win this amount of money, and you move up the ladder and you can prepare mentally for it. It's Spin and Go, it's just like boom. You're playing for $1 million right now in the next 5 minutes. You know, what are you going to do?
Well,
and there's just nothing like it in poker. It's, it's very exciting.
It's amazing because we've talked about it before, but it's the biggest bubble in poker. I mean, I understand that the main event final table, there's going to be bigger differences than 900,000, right? Because the million for first, 100,000 for second.
It's not even close.
But ROI, it's insane. And you're throwing it at people who are sitting there in their pajamas and their you know, living room with their laptop, and all of a sudden they're playing for a $900,000 difference. And then on the table it says deal making unavailable, kind of like you better be ready to play this one because we're not going to stop this tournament and make a deal. So I get a kick out of that too. You're just throwing normal people into this life changing environment. It's pretty interesting.
I mean, the up and down of it is like you said. You know, suddenly you're playing for $1 million. You're completely elated. Then you have to focus for a few minutes, and then two of the guys are going to bubble, and then they're going to be disappointed, and then 5 or 10 minutes later they're going to go, oh my gosh, I just won $100,000, and they're going to be happy, you know. So yeah. it's what a roller coaster of emotions, you know.
Oh, I know. I almost wish we could talk to the people, or you could do it if you could Twitch it somehow, or you could stream it live. I know you could. It can never happen, but having cameras in the room of these people while they play it would be amazing.
Just agree to consent turn on your webcam.
Can you imagine? That would be fantastic.
Just like put in the terms and conditions. We agree to turn on your webcam if you're selected for $1 million.
You have 3 minutes to turn your webcam on. You mentioned somebody won one, Matthew. Samara Lucio from Brazil won the first one. You're 2 days into the promotion. This is the $5 Spin and Goes on Pokerstars, where 1 million tournaments are going to be going, hopefully, randomly. She's a regular player in Brazil. I think she plays the Brazilian Series of Poker, the PCA. She's got some experience. I ended up watching this on YouTube as well, and the person who finished second was from Lithuania. And first of all, the tournament got to, I believe, 6120 blinds, which I've played a bunch of these. I've never had one get to 6120. You got to remember the starting stacks are 500.
Well, that's because you're in it.
Yeah, it's true. I'm blasting away. But it was like in the first, the guy who finished second, they got heads up and they played like 35 hands, I believe. And the guy who finished second must have folded 20 of them, 22 of them, something crazy. They were just, it was just a fold machine, and I was just screaming at the screen, God, shove it in, shove it in, shove it in. It was tilting, but yeah, I guess when you're in the moment and you have a $900,000 bubble, that's kind of what happens. People kind of change the way they play.
Yeah, it lasted over 100 hands.
That's crazy.
The whole thing. I think it was 30-something hands of when it was three-handed, and then heads up, they played like 80-something hands.
Did they play 80 hands?
Yeah.
Wow.
That's what our press release said. Anyhow, I didn't watch it, but wow. Yeah. So, I mean, it's just, yeah, I guess, you know, that's the hard part about playing for that kind of money. You know, you don't want to... I guess you don't want to take chances.
You don't want to make a mistake, making a mistake sometimes. But
you're making mistakes, exactly, exactly.
Well, hey, he's up 99,000, like, and something playing.
Yeah, he's doing all right.
Yeah, it's a brutal bubble, but at the same time, I mean, that was one of the things when we first were launching these and discussing these. We were like, you know, winner take all. It's just... I think some of our competitors had winner take all, and we're like, that's so,
you don't
want to, so hard to hit the
suicide.
It's so, yeah. It's so hard to hit these multipliers, and give them, you win when you get the, when you hit the jackpot, you're going to win a lot of money. You're gonna be a lot happy. And of course, then you have the chance at the life changing money as well. So,
yeah. I mean, part of the old school poker player in me wishes there was deal making available, because you know, this is cumulative money coming from guys who grind these things. So, you know,
I like it better this way. I'm going to say I'm just as old school as you. I like the degen aspect of making people play for it. It's like you said, it's like Matthew's saying, it's like a soft landing at 100K. So it's not, you know, it's not, you're not quite ready to jump off the highest building when you just picked up 100K and now you're now 99 life,
Terrence
K,
likes,
lifetime.
Terrence likes the cage fighting aspect of it.
He does, yeah.
Exactly.
I think the 100K was the second and third. I think that's, was kind of, you know, the in-between answer, I guess, between if it's winner take all and you almost feel like you have to have deal making, but it's like it kind of takes away from the whole concept of what it is. Offering the second and third place prize, I think I like it. I know there's people
really
out there
nasty
that would love the deal making, but I, you know, this is the concept, and I think I like it a lot.
You could make it real nasty by paying 200K for second and like 10K for third. But I'm just a bad
person. That's terrible.
Yeah, you could charge people $100,000 for finishing second too. You can make a penalty for finishing second.
I know we talked about this a couple of weeks ago, but we ran the all-in shootout.
Oh right,
that had $1 million the first place, and we slowed it down at the when it got to four-handed. We slowed it down, and that was million. You know, it was take all $1 million.
Yeah.
First. Now all the people that were playing it, they had already won 9,000. Let's see, what are they won?
Not,
9,000.
I mean, nothing compared
they
to the million.
$7,911.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was a winner take all, and we slowed it down, which had to be brutal for the guys watching.
Oh,
you know, that went deep in that, but.
Even bigger bubble. There's a deposit bonus available for people right now to get some free Spin and Go tickets, I understand, in the anniversary celebration here.
Yes. All you need to do is deposit $10. Bonus code is anniversary. And then you get $2.50 of Spin and Go tickets. This promotion is the $1 million Spin and Go. We have a little twist. Previously, it's been a $5 buy-in, but we also now have a 50-cent buy-in. So, and we also increased our multipliers for all of our Spin and Goes. used to be 3,000x, and now they're all 10,000x.
Okay.
So the $100 buy-in now is paying out $1 million, and the dollar is obviously paying out $10,000.
Nice.
So,
all right.
And those are permanent changes. The multipliers are going to stay fixed at the 10,000 rate. And we'll see how this 50 cent will. You know, it's going to be really hard for a 50 cent to hit the million, but we'll see what happens.
Increasing variance for those guys grinding those things out. There's an announcement of some VIP club changes. These have been talked about for a little while. This is, of course, the VIP program for on PokerStars. There's going to be some changes in 2016. When can we hear the announcement of exactly what's going to happen there, Matthew?
Yes, a few months ago I had posted it, you know, in the forums at 2+2 and said we'd be announcing in mid-October. We've been working really, really hard to try to meet that date, but unfortunately we're not quite ready. We still have a few final details that are being discussed and the communication. So we're not going to meet October. I understand players want to know, and trust me, we do want to communicate. We want to communicate as quickly as possible because we do understand that this has a big impact on especially the high volume players, and they want to make their plans. And as much as we want to announce as soon as possible, we have to get the details finalized, and we just haven't made it. So we're continuing to work hard, and all I can say right now, I don't have a fixed date that I can give you guys, but we're continuing to work really hard every day and in the hope that we can announce very soon. But that's okay. Pretty much where we're at right now.
Fair enough. Thank you so much, Matthew, for your time. Really appreciate it, and we will talk to you next week.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, guys.
Thanks to Matthew for joining us again this week. The Invitational, why don't we get that out of the way? This is the PokerStars Invitational for PokerCast listeners. This is a $1.10 buy-in, $500 added each week by PokerStars. Value added for this tournament. You can find it in the private tab of the tournament's lobby. It has a password. It's password protected each week. We are doing 2 weeks in advance now, so this week's the October 25th tournament was announced last week. The 6 max progressive knockout, no limit hold'em. Password is Malta, all small letters, all one word. Now, we're going to announce the November 1st edition. Why don't we do 4 max, no limit hold'em? We haven't done 4 max for a while, have we?
Sounds right. Yeah. A little while ago.
It's definitely been a while since we've been back to No Limit Hold'em.
Yeah, no, let's get back to a little bit of No Limit Hold'em. So we're going to do 4 Max No Limit Hold'em. The password is going to be PCA 2016, all small letters and numbers. You can't do small numbers, but small letters.
Lowercase numbers.
Lowercase numbers. Lowercase letters and numbers. The satellites are going for a PCA. I think I'm going to try and win one of these suckers. I don't know if we're going to be able to go to it, but if I win one of these things, I guess I'm going to have to get a bunch of cash. Tia, you're going to go to the PCA this year?
I don't think so. I'm on the wrong side of the globe for the PCA, dude. If you're the rule is if you're in,
oh, I see.
If you're in that side of the world, you go at Aussie Millions, which I can say now because it's an APPT.
Are you going to the Aussie Millions?
I'm leaning towards it. I think I'm like 70%. It kind of see how the fighting and the training going. I mean, certainly if I break my arm again, I'll be there. But we'll see. I love Melbourne. I had a great time there last time. The only thing that gives me pause is remember last week we had that writer that emailer.
That's right, what I was thinking.
The rake. And then I was like, oh man, do I really want to support that? But I have a good time going over there. So I enjoy the city. So. I would say it's a small favorite. I would say it's not a lock.
The tournament rake wasn't too bad. It's in line with a lot of different terms. It's
in line
game
with
rake.
Most tournaments, I
was
think.
Brutal.
Yeah, it sounds ridiculous.
But Melbourne is such a great city.
Yes,
it is. If I could pick one tournament to go to every year, it would be the Aussie Millions for sure. Okay, so password for the 4 Max No Limit Hold'em on November 1st, PCA 2016. All right, so let's jump into some other stuff. We did go long a little bit with the interviews in our first segment, so we might not get to everything we had planned, but I did quickly want to mention, in case you missed it, the draft day for the Global Poker League. Remember, we had Alex Dreyfus on last week talking about the Global Poker League. The draft has been announced for Thursday, February 26th in L.A. at the SLS Hotel. I believe they did the GPI Awards there as well. It's going to be live streamed. 12 teams again, remember, we talked about it, is and each team's going to have a representative in attendance. And
do you think he gets to 12 teams by February 26th?
I think one way or the other he will. You know, whether it's something, you know, it doesn't, the response isn't what he hoped, I think he'll still figure out a way to get it done. So I think something will happen there and get it done. He's got a lot of, like you suggest, I mean, I can tell what you're saying. He's got some roadblocks, right? Like, he's got a lot of things, some hurdles to jump.
Yeah, it's just so soon, I mean, to be able to try to get cobble up investors and get all of this thing going. February 26th seems like it's such an ambitious date.
Yeah, and what was it? Somebody sent me a tweet with the quote from Alex from our interview. And it was something like every part of this is impossible, which is why it's fun or something. I can't remember what he exactly said during the interview, but yeah, no question. He's going to have to get over a bunch of hurdles before he, you know, finding 12 people who are interested and you know, all the details to work out. But it seems like he's well on his way. So, and then somebody, an early email bag here. We won't get into the drop or anything because we'll get that later. But listener Bob sent in an email saying, I think it'd be interesting if the three of you each picked a GPL city and had a mock draft. You could each draft three players from the GPI top 1,000 and then draft two wildcards. I think it'd be fun for you guys to have a balance, making the team as competitive as possible and making the team as popular as possible, building local loyalty. And once your teams are drafted, the listeners could vote on who the best team is in the forums. Just a suggestion, keep up the good work. I thought that'd be fun. Maybe we could do that next week. We could draft a GPL team for each of our cities. T, you like it?
Sure, why not?
Let's do that next week.
Wait, we have three different cities? Is Ross representing Bowen Island?
Oh, yeah. Ross is east side.
The Bowen Arrows.
Yeah.
Excellent. So he's already way ahead of us. He's already thought this out and has a team name and everything.
Bowen Arrows, I love it. And I will be Maple Ridge, BC. So, yeah. And you can be Hong Kong. So
I was actually born in Vancouver. I'm the only one of the three of us that was actually born in Vancouver.
Yeah, no, that's incorrect. True. I was born in Vancouver as well. All right. So we'll do that next week. That'll be fun. One other quick thing I wanted to get to in case you missed it. Christian Lusardi. Remember, this is the Borgata tournament cheater who was caught flushing counterfeit.
It's never going to get old. Like, feel free. Like, don't even apologize for like, so not being able to get through the sentence without laughing, because it's so good. Like, we'll never forget the guy who tried to get away with flushing chips down a toilet.
He thought that was going to be a good idea. Yeah, no, he brought counterfeit chips in and got caught flushing down the toilet and, got a bill for the plumbing as well. He took a plea last August that allowed him to avoid a possible 15-year sentence. The plea deal resulted in a $463,000 fine for Lusardi, which is the amount the Borgata lost when they canceled the tournament. The 43-year-old also admitted to counterfeiting and criminal mischief. He also must pay $9,400 to Harris for damaging the pipes. He tried to flush the chips down the toilet. That's a big plumber bill right there, $9,400. So he was sentenced to 5 years in prison. They don't screw around when you get caught in some states. 5 years.
Yeah, the evidence is right there. Yeah. Why couldn't that have happened to the World Series guy?
But people flippantly do that, right? Like, I'm sure they do. I'm going to take tournament chips into this tournament that I took last tournament. They don't realize,
had people like kind of say to me, like people who don't understand casinos or gambling or anything like that, like, you know, they'll see a $5,000 chip or something like that and be like, I could copy this. Like, this is easy. I'm like, well, first of all, it's like not technically as easy as you think it is. You know, you have to find print chip, but even if you could, it's pretty damn dangerous to try to counterfeit chips.
Yeah, no question. All right, let's get to some mailbag.
And now,
that right there is the mail. Now let's talk about the mail. Can we talk about the mail, please, Mac? I'm dying to talk about the mail for you all day. Okay.
Mailbag.
John writes, "Hi, gents. Long-time listener. I'm a keen recreational player who has always looked to improve my game. To aid my online game, I purchased PT4. I'll be the first to admit I probably only use 10% of its capability. I mainly use it for reviewing my hands afterwards and identifying errors and trends. My understanding is that the current trend now is to stop players from downloading hand histories. I rarely use HUDs at the table, but can see them. Can see the harm of downloading hand histories and using this data away from the table. I feel this is a step too far and could in the long term turn keen recreational players off. We won't be able to use that great tool to improve our game. 332 miles from Kells." Interesting that a recreational player is, you know, we always talk about protecting the recreational players and getting rid of HUDs and Poker Tracker, but this is a different sort of tact from a recreational player who thinks we should keep these things.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the mistake is to sort of think recreational player equals losing player or equals not serious player. I think there are a lot of recreational players out there who are serious about improving, right? Like, they're just by definition, they don't play for a living, for a job, and therefore they must consider themselves recreational players. I mean, I'm a recreational player in a sense. Poker's not my full-time job anymore. So, I guess this is sort of conflating the two. But, yeah, interesting to come back full circle from, you know, our IPWOF induction earlier in the day and talking about Poker Tracker here and its effect. Like, it's everywhere.
Mark writes, "Hi, guys. Good show. Major fanboy. Love your stuff. Kiss, kiss, schmooze, 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 etc. Just wondering, is it me or has anybody else commented on how much Adam sounds like Kermit when he does his Welcome to the 2+2 Pokercast intro?"
I had
no idea it sounded like Kermit. I'm not going to read it all.
2D Pokercast.
Yeah, he's got a long email because
there's a giant vagina.
There's a lot. What the hell is that? Nice. Mark talks about some bad rulings that he had at his local casino in Aberdeen, Scotland. I've been to Aberdeen, by the way. Played at a golf course up a little bit north called Cruden Bay, but Aberdeen was awesome. But I will read part of it. Mark writes, "I was in the big blind in seat 4 of 9. So this is in Aberdeen. Blind 600, 1200, ante 50. The pot was limped 5 ways, myself and 4 other players all the way around to me, and with unsuited middling semi-connectors. And knowing that a raise would likely get called in no less than 3 or 4 spots, leaving me with a bad hand out of position, I check the action in the big blind. The dealer proceeds to scoop in the blinds and deal out the change. Just as he reaches for the shoe to deal, the guy in seat 7 announces to hold on that the single 5,000 chip he put out was meant to be a raise to 3,000. Now, admittedly, the table had been quite chatty. No one really heard the raise, including the dealer. Under the gun limped, seat 6 folded, seat 7 placed a single 5,000 chip in the pot. Seat 8 folded, seat 9 folded, seat 1 folded, button called, and the small blind completed. At this point, it was obvious there was a confusion, and everybody past seat 7 thought it was a limp pot. There was a discussion between all the players, and no one had heard him say raise, including the dealer. Seat 8 then piped up and said that he'd heard him say raise to 3,000, and that's why he folded. So, this is an issue, a single chip rule, right? When you put a single chip into the pot, it's a call, it's not a raise. So,
unless you say raise.
Yeah, and Mark writes, "Now this is where it gets interesting. The dealer, despite having just said that he's not heard anyone announce raise, now says he trusts seat 8, and if that seat 8 heard him say raise, then the bet stands. Terrible ruling, I think. I hope he called a floor man he didn't say over to have that overturned, because there was significant action behind, and you know, nobody else heard him, including the dealer, say raise."
Yeah, this one's a really clear one from a tournament director's perspective. As you mentioned, substantial action. It's very clear you have 3 people putting chips into the pot, I mean, including the big blind, but yeah, there's 2 folds and a call of the 1,200, presumably with something that looks more like 1,200 than 3K, right? I mean, if you're meant to make it 3K, what are you doing when you watch the button calling 1,200, the small blind completing it to 1,200, and then the big blind checking, and then now you're going to be like, oh, wait, I raised. Like, no, that's that's not even close. That's an easy ruling. It's it doesn't actually matter whether whether he said raise or not at this point, because there's way too much substantial action for this to be ruled a raise.
Morgs13 writes, "Hello, Adam, Terrence, and Rossco. Writing from just outside Chicago in Lockport, Illinois, which is 3,669 miles from Kells, I'm a 45-year-old recreational player who's been listening to the podcast since 2008 when driving to and from work while the kids at baseball and soccer practice. I've been playing poker for 30 years. I may be old in the online world, but not as old as Adam.
Ooh,
yes. Ouch.
Giant vagina.
I can hold my own live in both cash and tournaments, but online I'm a stone fish. My deepest online tourney run was a second place in a World Series of Poker qualifier in Carbon in 2010 for $3,200. Since then, nothing. I've got three younger kids, 13, 11, and 7, and a full-time job, and not much time to play. So when I do play online, I feel like I have to play quick and seem to play way too many hands. To combat this, I've decided to play mainly heads-up sit-and-goes in order to get action in a short amount of time. I have to play and to practice deep runs in live tournaments. Any suggestions on a good book or training site for learning to optimize heads-up play? I would say don't play heads-up, heads-up sit-and-goes, if you're going to be a casual player. Honestly, I mean, these we're getting close to playing those things perfectly, I think. I just don't think
even when you're not playing perfectly, you're playing against guys who play them 9 hours a day.
Well, that's what I mean. Yeah, those guys are getting close to playing perfectly, right? So your opponents are, A, they're going to bum hunt you, and B, you're going to have to sit there and play against very, very good players who play close to perfect.
I think it depends how much you're playing for, though. If you're playing $10, $15 ones, you don't have to worry too much.
I mean, they're still pretty good there. They're tough, right? I mean, yeah, you're going to get better. You're going to be playing against tougher opponents. You're not going to get great results right off the bat at all, I don't think, unless you spend a lot of time, you know, investing in training tools in your game and all that kind of stuff. If I was a casual player and I wanted to get quick action, I would probably be trying to play something else. T, what do you think?
Yeah, I agree with you on that. It's tough playing heads up. I wanted to get your thoughts on this, though, because, you know, it sounds like his kids are kind of similar in age to your kids.
Yeah.
And you also have to deal with the distraction of having to, like, shuttle kids around.
Yep.
Banging on your office door. And it feels like he's saying he doesn't play well because he's got the kids in the house, or he's got these responsibility with the kids. Like, you know, you've been playing online poker for a living for a long time with kids that are similar aged. I mean, is this the kind of thing where, like, you have to, like, maybe you should leave the house and play online poker? Do you lock yourself in the room and say, don't disturb dad? Like, what's the strategy with respect to that?
I can't play when they're awake. I can't focus. There's always something going on, dad, or something you don't want to be missing out on, right, that's going on, or, you know, watching a movie that you like or whatever, helping with homework. I mean, there's a million things. So when they go to bed is generally when I play. Plus, I'm lucky in Canada. We have access to Pokerstars. I can play Zoom. If I'm going to play quickly, like if I've got an hour to go ahead and play, I can go sit and play, you know, a bunch of hands of Zoom real quick if they're coming home from school, whatever. So, that part, for me, he doesn't have, he's in Chicago, so he doesn't have access to
that. And he's got a full-time job too. So this is how he makes his living. So it's not as easy, but, I just still thought it was sort of interesting.
He had a question for you, Terrence. Are there any books, articles that you can recommend for bet sizing? I feel like this is my biggest leak, is I either scare people out, leave money on the table by not betting enough, or let them get there when they want to fold, when I want them to fold. I'm looking for something semi-basic that would apply both live and online cash games to start.
Yes, there is. It's not a book or an article, but what you need to see is Mike McDonald Timex's video on the MIT poker lecture that is hosted by Will Ma. I saw this once when it first came out, and then maybe again about 6 months ago. Timex gives a very good lecture about bet sizing, basically it relates to flop textures and bet sizing and bet, you know, frequency and all that kind of stuff. So check that one out. I think there might be better resources out there, but it's certainly the best one I've encountered.
Rossco, I'd like to thank you for providing a few laughs to me, my 11-year-old, and his friends with the Making Bacon Pancakes drop you played earlier this year.
A giant vagina.
We could not stop singing
That's
it
not
for
the
several
one.
Weeks.
He's got an 11-year-old, Ross.
We got up. We got a lot of mileage out of that one. Good luck at the tables. Stick to brick and mortar, a.k.a. real poker.
Yeah. What was, sir, Terrence, what was the name of that video again?
If you Google MIT Mike McDonald poker, something like that, you probably should be able to. Yeah, there it is. It's MIT Poker Class 2013 Lecture 6 featuring Mike Timex McDonald. So there you go. Throw that in your Googles.
P.S. Jason Kuhn was going to post a diet and workout regimen after he was on the show a few months ago. Where can I find that? He and Terrence both did a a thread in the Pokercast forum. I can't
Pokercast.2plus2.com. I can't remember. Although it might not be on the front page right now, I guess.
Yeah, I think you probably have to go to the second page to find it. But check that out for sure. All right, let's get to... we got one quick shout-out. The Where in the World Are You Listening From thread.
That was a good one.
What's that?
That was a good one that you're going to get to the marathon guy.
Yeah, right? Yeah. Jaron Minkier was running the Amsterdam Marathon, listening to the Pokercast. He'd finished it just under 4 hours. Wow, that's damn good. And he was listening to the show while running the marathon, which is kind of the opposite of what you would think you would.
That's how long the show has gotten now. People are
kidding.
Like, it for their marathon grind.
I didn't think of that. That's terrible. all right, before we get to the Rossco Report, let's do 140 or less. I got a quick one there.
140 characters. That's it. I love hashtags. I love all of them.
Terrence Chan
needs more than 140 characters to express himself.
140 or less.
At Real Kid Poker, they seem to be Daniel Negreanu
every
week.
4 weeks in a row now.
Question of the day. If you leave a baby to fend for itself and put a bunny and an apple in its crib, which would he eat and which would he play with? Of course,
is
Daniel.
Is this like a brain teaser?
Well, no, he's a vegan, right? So he's trying to point out the fact that why...
That's ridiculous.
It is.
So
because
you've got a bunny in your crib, so does he take the bunny over the bridge and he comes back with the apple? I don't know. Like, okay, yes, small infants do not have the ability to hunt. Is that your point?
I don't know. It's just like I was shaking my head.
That is apparently your point.
This is not a good question.
he also can't eat the apple. Babies don't have teeth.
Right.
Dumbass.
The baby dies, Daniel.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
like Trainspotting.
Play the Patrick Antonius. That's correct, because the fact is that babies without that's their mothers just die.
Now you got me thinking. Trainspotting. I can't watch that movie anymore.
And then it crawls on your ceiling, and its head turns all the way around and stares at you while you're withdrawing from heroin.
Yeah, exactly. also, the baby doesn't know how to marinate and barbecue yet. So if he did, he's probably going to pick the bunny, I'm thinking, but he doesn't. All right. At Scarevoy, Andreas Torbjørgensen. You got this one?
Yeah. Scarevoy is a listener to the show, and he's also a high-stakes PLO player. He tweeted at me to add timestamps to the show the other day, so maybe I'll start doing that on this episode. All this talk about Donald Trump, he retweeted this, and I thought it was funny. It's a piece of an article that says, Bloomberg puts Trump's current net worth at $2.9 billion, Forbes at $4.1 billion. The National Journal has worked out that if Trump had... just put his father's money into a mutual fund and tracked the S&P 500 and spent his career finger painting, he'd have $8 billion.
Donald Trump, successful businessman, Donald Trump.
Doing all the shit that he's done, if he would have just dumped it in a mutual fund, he'd have twice as much money. I love it.
Okay. China!
Rossco Report.
Sure glad he's all right.
Listen, boy, you gotta pick your spots good. You gotta make hay while the sun shines. Good deal. You dipstick!
It's time for a Rossco Report.
All right, let's kick off the... this is from a live session, is it?
Yeah, I played a long time on... Saturday, I got there. I started the game, and it was a very good game.
Usually not when it starts. Okay, good.
Yeah. It was just a bunch of older people kind of trying to spend their Saturday.
A little bit of gambling?
Shipping chips back and forth.
Nice.
PLO. Yeah,
1-2-5.
1-2-5. So I ran back. There was this lady who was on my right who played... 99% of hands.
That's awesome.
And did not have a winning day. So I was sitting on her left, like two to her left, and I just couldn't make a hand against her. I lost a few buy-ins. So this is later on in the day. I have 5, 7, 9, 10 with one suit, the 10 and 5.
Those 10 high flushes?
It's the 10 high flush draws, yeah, but you could also have a 9 or a 7 high flush
draw. You have 10, 9, 7, 5?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
So I have 600-ish behind.
Okay.
We're playing 10-handed, I think, in this hand. So, and I think I have a tight image because I haven't played that many hands.
Because the game just started.
No, this is later. I said this was later.
Why do you really think 10-9-7-5 is that bad? I mean, it makes a lot of nut hands. I don't think 10-9-7-5 is terrible.
Well, it depends on the action. Okay, let's go.
It's raised to 15 early. What do you play? What hands do you play? Just like only rundowns and big pairs?
I don't know. Okay, let's go. I mean, this is a full ring game. This isn't a 6 max Zoom table where you're playing a lot more hands.
That's okay, true. Okay, so it's raised to 15 early. I call.
Wait, you're the first caller in 15?
I was in the hijack.
15 early.
He was in the hijack.
You called right behind?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, so people, a bunch of people in between folded.
Yeah.
Like.
Okay.
The cutoff.
So who raised? Like, is this the woman that raised?
No, just some guy in the early.
Okay.
So I call.
Cutoff calls, button calls, big blind calls.
Yes. So the pot's $75, and I flop the nuts, 4-6-8 with a flush draw.
Not your flush.
Not my flush.
4-6-8, 2 diamonds. You again have 10-9-5-7.
So you couldn't have hit this any harder because you have the nuts, and then you have, other than diamonds, a bunch of redraws.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it checks to me, and since there's 3 people behind me, I end up checking, and then it checks around. So the turn's another 6, not a great card.
8-6-4 flop, 6 turn.
Yes. So it checks to me again. I lead for 55 and a 75, and then the button on my left calls, and then the original pre-flop raiser calls. So
okay.
I'm in the middle going to the river. The river is a 4, so the board is 4-6-8-6-4.
Double paired.
The pot's 240, and checks to me. So I figure I can bet for value here. Because, I mean, I suppose I could have gotten called by, like, pocket eights or something that's going to slow play me. But if I get raised, I guess I just fold.
Oh, you're good. You're good most of the time here, I think.
Yeah,
yeah, I would think so. At that point. Okay, let's go through that. I'm probably going to fold that in pre-flop. I don't know that that's a hand I'm going to... Well, I mean, it's not terrible, but I don't love it. All right, so as played, we get to the flop... 4-6-8 is the flop. We flop the nuts with the straight redraws. There's a flush draw. I'm always going to bet that flop because if you polarize yourself when you're only betting, not your nut hands on the flop. Like,
yeah.
I understand there's a lot of people who aren't going to pay attention to the stuff in your game, but you can't really polarize yourself to checking all your nut hands. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
So I'm going to lead that flop because I'm going to lead a lot. I'm going to lead with lots of other hands with that flop, right?
Would you bet a naked 5-7 without redraws?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
so,
I would, but I would also bet a bunch of other
hands.
Well,
then that's sort of an argument against that, right? Like, so just because you check there doesn't mean that you have it or you don't have it.
No, I understand that, but also it's a hand worth defending, right? I mean, you know, I'm just saying.
Yeah, I mean, I would bet too, but for value, right? Like, I mean, you know, you're betting for value here,
right?
Because it's so unlikely that you're up against the dominated hand. Like, literally, the guy would have the same hand as you with diamonds, which is not going to happen very often. So.
Right.
I mean, yeah.
So the turn comes, board pairs. I don't mind the bet now as played. Both guys call, so you're likely good still. 4 comes in the river, double paired board. You're probably still good. 25 as played. That the turn and river are fine.
It's a great run out. I mean, in terms like
yeah.
The 4 in the river is pretty much the as good as you hope for there.
What was the result?
They both folded.
Yeah. Okay, took it down.
Yeah,
all right, next hand.
The next hand, I have ace king 10-6 double suited in the cutoff, about 600 behind. So it's limp by 2 people under the gun. The guy on my right makes it 25. I call. The button calls. Both limpers call.
Okay, hang on. So just pre-flop, did you think about 3-betting at all? This is not a bad hand to 3-bet here.
Well, I mean, nobody's ever folding to a 3-bet.
That's fine. You got two double. You got ace high and flush and king high.
You're,
flush
you're only worried against like aces repotting it.
Yeah,
that's basically the only concern.
That's
there.
True.
Okay.
No.
Anyway,
I didn't really. Consider
I think some of the times there, I'm going to three bet. Anyway, yeah. Okay. So you call, a bunch of people call. That's fine.
Pot's 125. The flop is king, queen, six, rainbow.
Again, you have ace, king, 10-6.
Yeah.
Flop king, queen, six.
Yeah. So it checks to me.
Top and bottom.
So. There's only one person to act behind me, so I figure I probably have the best hand in this spot, unless I get check-raised. So I bet 70 into 125. The guy on my left calls.
The button, yep.
And then folds around to the guy on my right, who also calls.
Okay, so you have a gutter and top and bottom.
Yeah, and backdoor flush draws.
Yep.
So the turn is a queen of clubs.
King, queen, six, flop, queen turn.
Yeah, so the guy on my right checks. And the queen scared me a bit, and I ended up checking.
Okay.
And then I checked through. So the river is the ace of clubs, bringing in the backdoor flush draw, king, queen, queen, six, ace. Or king, queen, six, queen, ace. The pot's 335. The guy on my right checks, and I really didn't think they were that strong here, and I was pretty sure the guy on my right had a straight draw, and I tanked, but I just couldn't end up pulling the trigger because I had a bit of showdown value, even though I thought it was a really good spot to bluff.
I was going to say, like, what are you going to bluff out? Enough showdown value just to check it down, right?
Yeah, you've got, but you know, you beat everything but a queen, right?
Yeah.
So, do they have
Jack
queens?
10.
And are they going to fold queens, right?
Oh,
wait, no, you have full house.
What? No, I don't. I only have king.
He has top two pair.
I'm sorry.
Like, the backdoor flush
four
draw
pair.
Game, so... Right. You're losing to a flush, you're losing to Jack 10 first, right, and losing to any queen.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think the turn, once you bet the flop,
yeah,
I think you should probably fire in the turn.
Yeah.
You're going to find out on the turn. It's going to take a big hand to call you on the turn after you lead flop and lead turn.
Yeah.
So I think it's going to take a pretty big hand for a guy to guy to call the turn. Again, I don't play in this game much, so I don't really
but
know.
But there is a guy like in position. Like the only reason I don't like barreling again on the turn is that there is still a guy in position on you. And I think, you know. That is a little bit dangerous to me, I think.
Yeah.
So, like, in a heads-up pot where you're in position, yeah, you're absolutely right. Like, you can just bet the turn and just expect that the guy won't be able to take enough heat to be able to call you down on two streets without a queen or without some kind of other big hand. But I'm not sure when there is still a guy in position on you whether that's the right play.
Fair enough. River, I mean, are you going to check call?
No, I was going to fold if someone bet.
You're going to fold someone.
There's a flush, right. There's straight, there's full house, and I have two pair.
Yeah.
So I was just, I guess, hoping to get a check through, but I thought a bluff would get through.
You're just almost never going to win that pot, right?
Yeah.
If
so,
you check it through.
Yeah, it ended up getting checked through, and then just a bare straight took it down.
Gotcha.
But I thought, yeah, if I don't bet the turn, then betting the river is a lot
pretty
more
strange.
Fishy.
Yeah.
I probably don't check a full house on the turn.
Okay, next hand.
All right, this was my big double up hand. Sorry to spoil it. it was against the super spewy lady. She had so much money at this point. And I had essentially been bum hunting her all day for like 12 hours.
Okay.
So I have queen, queen, 7-8, double suited, diamonds and clubs on the button.
Okay.
950 behind, covered by everybody in the hand.
Wow.
So it two people... limp to me on the button. I make it 20. The big blind calls and both limpers call. So the pot's 80.
Okay.
I flop queen 9-5 with a flush draw. So
not your flush draw though, right?
Queen 9 of spades. No, not my flush draw.
So you have top set and a gutter.
Top set and a gutter. Checks to the crazy lady who excitedly says pot. And I decide to just... I mean, I haven't seen her play draws too aggressively, but I've seen her go nuts with two pair or any pair. So, I just flat because I think she's going to put in more money on the turn. And
Wait. You just said she plays made hands aggressively, and you've got the nut made hand.
Mm-hmm.
Why wouldn't you
right.
raise there and have her... If she's not playing draws aggressively, then she probably...
She's dead. She's, like, she has middle set or top two
yeah.
pair, right?
Right. So, in that spot, if you think she's playing made hands aggressively, you got the nut made hand. Why wouldn't you raise there and try and get the money in?
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. So, well, my thinking was if a blank comes on the turn, she's going to pot and we can easily get the money in. And if I raise, she's going to be suspicious if she only has, like, bottom two pair or something.
But you said she goes crazy with two pair.
Yeah, but she hasn't seen me play that many hands, and I think it might scare her if I repot.
What would you plan to do if, like, a six of spades rolls off on the turn?
Or you got
the
nuts.
Oh, sorry.
He's
like,
got the nuts.
Seven of spades or something like that.
Yeah. Then you're in. Yeah. Okay. So, anyway, my point, I guess, there is I'm raising. Okay. So, you call. You flat her.
I end up flatting.
Her
and
pot.
Then it gets
pot bet.
One call behind.
Okay.
So, it's essentially a blank on the turn. It's the ace of clubs.
Okay.
So, under the gun checks, she insta-pots again.
Wow.
For 320.
Okay.
So I take a few seconds. I put my whole stack in. So it's pot 640. I have like 800 more.
Yep.
And guy behind folds, and she's like, oh, like, you have fives, like, blah, blah, blah. Says some stuff.
She can't beat fives.
Yeah. And she calls.
She's got queen nine?
No. She had 9995.
What?
In her hand.
She thought you had fives?
She's like,
That's the hand that she thought you had holding a five in her hand.
And all three
and
nines.
All the nines,
but
yeah.
she did have a spade draw, and I faded it, so that was good.
Oh, wow. So she flops middle set and a spade draw. Okay. Yeah. Wow, yeah. So I guess the only way I'd play that differently is we'd probably get it all in on the flop.
Yeah. Yeah, it doesn't really change the outcome that much. Yeah. But
although you pick up, I guess, the pot call from the other guy on the flop.
Yeah, going a little more money, but still,
don't actually know if that helps you. The guy could have had like
Right.
If the jack of spades rolls off on the turn, I'm hating my life.
Yep. Omaha.
Yeah.
All right, last hand.
So the last hand was after I'm playing really deep, after winning that pot. So.
You have about 2,000 behind?
About 2,000, yeah. I have ace, king, jack, nine double suited now. Hearts and diamonds to the big cards. So it's raised to 15 under the gun, plus one.
Okay.
There's three calls behind him. So this is a hand I don't mind raising, especially not, I'm quite
absolutely
deep now.
Absolutely. Ace, king,
I
jack,
think even
nine
Adam
double
raises
suited. Well, I'm raising the other one that he flatted. But yeah, I'm definitely three betting here too.
Okay, so I make it 70, which isn't actually a pot-sized raise.
Yeah, that's okay.
And everybody calls.
Okay.
So the flop is king 9-5.
You have ace, king, jack, 9.
Yes.
Top so two pair with no real other redraw.
Yeah. So there's a 9-5 of clubs. Pretty draw-heavy board. It checks to me, so I bet 325 into 350. There's one caller in the middle, older fella. And so he just flats, and the turn is the ace of spades. Not completing any draws, giving me three pair. So he checks, and I just bet pot.
Yeah, I think that's played perfectly, personally. I'm playing it exactly the same way. I might not bet
if he shoves it on you.
I might not bet.
Still putting it in.
325 into 350, but that's a small nitpick. Okay.
Would you bet less?
Maybe a shade less, not much less. I don't know. It depends on the situation.
But you're getting it in regardless, right?
Like, so
it's unfortunate. Like if the guy shoves it on you, he probably has you smashed. But I mean, what are you gonna do?
What ends up happening?
He folded. He shed. Okay. He had king six of clubs.
Well, so that's pretty good session.
You have all the blockers. So, I mean, he should fold most of the time.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it was the last few sessions were really good. I got unstuck from
the big downturn.
For the size of the game, but kind of big for my bankroll. So I don't know. I'm thinking about getting back online. I was talking about it with Mr. Joe Ingram, and I think it's a good idea to improve,
get back on,
improve my game.
Battle the regs?
You can always just play smaller.
I suppose I could, but that's not very fun.
exactly.
Yeah, but I've been watching Jay Nandez stream.
Oh,
he's
how's he
inspired
doing?
Me quite a bit.
How's he doing in his quest?
He's not doing so good the last few days. He's running really bad. But playing short sessions, only playing 2-3 tables is like so much better, I think, than just getting tilted and playing for 15 hours when you're stuck.
I don't have his – I know he's doing a challenge right now. I don't have it in front of me to remember.
When I was watching yesterday, he had like he had like a 65K roll. He was on like almost day 70, so he's got some work to do.
What was the goal again? It was
100K.
5,000 to 100,000 or something?
It was 20K to 100K, 20K in 100 days.
Gotcha. I've been watching him a little bit as well, too. Check out Jay Nandez in his Twitch stream. That's going to do it for us, I think, this week. We want to thank Mr. Olivier Busquet for joining us and talking about his upcoming bout with JC Alvarado. Also Ryan Spittles for joining us and talking to a little bit about his trip around the USA playing poker. Thanks to Neil Channing for setting that up for us as well. Matthew Hilger for joining us from the Isle of Man to talk about some of the stuff going on there. Terrence, you from Berlin, we're going to have you from Hong Kong soon.
Yep, thank you. I won't force you to wake up at the ungodly hour of 11 a.m. anymore and make you do this year's radio show. So, I'll be in Hong Kong, and I'll be the one waking up at gross, disgusting hours when we do it from there. APPT Macau, not too far around the corner. It's that's kind of where this thing sort of all started.
That's right.
Remember, I joined the PokerCast a little bit before then. You guys came out to Macau not long after.
Yeah.
Indeed. Yeah.
That was a fun trip.
Fun time. Bunner is still there? No, he's home.
No.
And thanks to Ross for coming all the way out here.
Is this enough?
To the suburbs and recording the program each week. But special thanks to you for listening. Thank you so much for spending time with us each week. Really, really appreciate it.
Join us in the forums.
Please, our weekly begging of you to come over to the forum and let us know where you're listening to and what you think about the show. And we will talk to you next week.
All right.
There you go.
Yep.
Tell me when we're recording.
Oh, we are.
Okay.
Please tell me
it's the early morning. Seconds ago. It's the early morning.
I said, yeah, whatever.
Thanks for joining us. The 2+2 Pokercast has been presented to you by the Pokerstars VIP.